Counselor Barry?
Here.
Counselor Fritz?
Here.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor Roberts?
Here.
Counselor Swift Kayata?
Here.
Counselor Watson?
Here.
Manager McGovern?
Here.
Thank you. With a pledge of allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. We have just... I'd like to tell the viewing audience at home that we have a very special presentation this evening, and I hope that you're watching. Could I have these two wonderful young children, girls, up to this podium, please? Daphne and Sheena. Somebody just told me to be sure if anybody wanted, family wanted to take a picture, that you should be able to get wherever you want to take the picture. We want the cameras to see you, not me. I'd like to read this proclamation from the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Whereas on June 22, 2000, Sheena Brunell was at Maiden Cove with her friend, Devaney Carroll, and whereas Devaney, due to a medical condition, fell off a cliff into the water and appeared to be sinking into the water without any indication that she was conscious of her predicament, and whereas Sheena Brunell, observing the condition of her friend Devaney, immediately jumped into the water and brought Devaney out of the water to a nearby rock and awaited further assistance. And whereas, as Sheena was dragging Devaney to the rock, Devaney was shaking and had turned blue, her eyes were open with a fixed glaze, and she was not breathing. And whereas Sheena covered Devaney with her own body to keep her warm, and Devaney started breathing again. And whereas Sheena, in helping her friend, developed scrapes on her legs and clearly acted in a manner that was selfless in ensuring the safety and rescue of Devaney. And whereas medical and police personnel have indicated that if Sheena had not come to the immediate rescue of her friend Devaney Carroll, that there was a likelihood that Devaney would not have survived this incident. Now, therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, in Town Council assembled, does hereby salute the heroism of Sheena Brunell in saving the life of Devaney Carroll. We find her fast response to her friend's plight to be an act that deserves much recognition and praise, as she is a heroine in every sense. We've given a lot of proclamations and resolutions, but that's got to be one of the best. I told them they get flowers because that's what ladies get when these things come about. Now, are there any more presentations?
No.
Reports and correspondence, please, from council.
Madam Chair.
Ann Swift Kayata, please.
On June 22nd, I just wanted to report that I attended, along with Jack Roberts, the COG Council of Governments annual meeting, and it was an excellent meeting. Carol Fritz was there also, and as was Henry Berry. And it was an interesting meeting, and then we concluded with a picnic and a Sea Dogs meeting, so it was well worth the evening. Other than that, I just want to commend everybody involved with Chief Pickering's reception on June 21st. It was a wonderful evening and well deserved by the chief.
Thank you. Anybody else? Manager? No? Town manager's report.
Yes, this evening, Mike Hill, one of the town's attorneys, is here.
and I'd like to ask him to give an overview of some recent issues, both before the zoning board and in court, that have related to the town of Cape Elizabeth. There was an opinion in the councilor's second packet that you should have received in the mail on Saturday, and I thought it would be good if he could elaborate a little bit on that, as well as to update you on some other issues.
Could we, Mike, get the zoning ordinance as item 19? Could you discuss that when we get to item 19 and just discuss the other ones first? Thanks.
We had a recent decision by the Superior Court on the Scout House restaurant, 1231 Associates wanted to put the restaurant in the Scout House, and the Planning Board reviewed the evidence and law and approved the site plan, and the Planning Board's decision has been upheld by the Maine Superior Court. The appeal period for that doesn't expire for another week or so. The Johnsons, who appealed that decision, have the right to appeal that to the Maine Supreme Judicial Court. Next week is the deadline for that. Another item, and so I guess to finish up the thought on that, Planning Board decision was that I think that the town should be proud of the job that the Planning Board did, because they thoroughly analyzed the facts and law that was before. The next item that I wanted to update you on was a recent decision by the town's Zoning Board of Appeals in the Caputo. Mr. and Mrs. Caputo wanted to put on an addition to their garage. The Zoning Board of Appeals had decided that they could not have the expansion that they had proposed, and the reason I want to bring it to your attention is because it's a change in the way that the town zoning board has interpreted expansion of non-conforming structures in the shoreland zone. And I believe that Mr. McGovern has distributed to you my letter, which goes into more detail. And the appeal period for that doesn't expire for a couple more weeks, so I really don't want to comment too much on that. But I wanted to let you know that there was a change in the way the town has interpreted that non-conformance section of the ordinance. And then I'll just answer any questions that you have regarding the variance when we get to that point.
That would be great when we get to item 19.
Mr. Hill's reluctant to comment because there could be some pending litigation on the Caputo Armstrong issue. But he did give a very good opinion that was in your second packet that I'd really suggest that you spend some time looking at it and considering it. It's a major change in interpretation of the ordinance and will affect greatly the ability to folks to do what they want or not to do what they want when they own property, particularly in shoreland setback areas. So it is an issue that, because of that decision, is going to be quite contentious in the future in terms of both individuals who want to change their homes and individuals who don't want to see other individuals change their homes. So it's something that is, I think, this is only the beginning of a very long issue, and one that's going to have much discussion in the years ahead.
These are the two little girls and my flowers out there flying around. Are there any items, citizens that have any discussion items that are not on the agenda that would like to raise them at this time? Hearing none, we'll move on to the minutes of the June 12th meeting for approval.
Madam Chair, I move that the minutes as read be approved.
I'll second that.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. We're going to move on to item 19, which is a public hearing. We will first have the public hearing, and then we'll close the public hearing, and then we'll have council action. This is council action upon the proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance relating to establishing a practical difficulty standard for certain variance requests. And I will ask Mike Hill again, as the town's attorney this evening, to give an overview of this variance issue.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The issue, as the council is well aware, is to relax, if you will, the variance standards. Presently, we have the state undue hardship test, which has been in existence for many, many years. It's a very difficult test to meet in order to get a variance request. Most variances, if the undue hardship criteria are strictly applied, would be denied. One of the major tripping points in the undue hardship standards is that the property cannot yield a reasonable rate of return unless the variance is granted. And the courts have interpreted that standard to mean that not just that you can't maximize your return, but you're going to basically lose the economic benefit of your property. So in response to that, statewide, there's been a lot of there's been a movement to relax the variance standards to have the practical difficulty standard, which, as I said, does relax quite a bit from the undue hardship. And I'll just give a brief summary of what the standards are. That the need for the variance is due to the unique circumstances of the property in question and not due to the general conditions of the neighborhood. That standard is the same. Granting of the variance will not produce an undesirable change in the character of the neighborhood and will not unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of abutting properties. This is a new standard and really gives the abutters to the property that is seeking a variance more standing to show it's going to adversely affect the abutting property, it's going to hurt the market value of my property. That is not a condition in the present undue hardship standards. The practical difficulty is not the result of action taken by the applicant or prior owner. That is the same standard as is in the undue hardship. There's no other feasible alternative to a variance. That's a new condition. Granting of the variance will not unreasonably adversely affect the natural environment. That's a new standard. This practical difficulty standard would only apply to those districts outside of the shoreline zone. Undue hardship, the harder standard, would still apply in the shoreline zone. The proposed language would keep the current standard that the variance cannot be issued for a use or structure otherwise prohibited by the ordinance. It also cannot be given to reduce the required lot area or street frontage or to reduce a setback to less than 10 feet or the shortest non-conforming setback distance created by the existing building. And it keeps the variance standard language for a variance for someone who has a physical disability. So you don't have to go through the practical difficulty standards if someone, for example, needed a setback variance to put in a ramp for a wheelchair, but the zoning board could condition the granting of that variance on have it limited to the length of time that the person with a disability used that property. And then in the Shoreland Performance Overlay District, the undue hardship standard would still be in effect, and that is that the land in question cannot yield a reasonable return unless the variance is granted. The need for the variance is due to the unique circumstances of the property, not to general conditions of the neighborhood. That the granting of the variance will not alter the essential character of the locality, and that the hardship is not the result of action taken by the applicant or a prior owner. I'd be happy to answer any questions that the council may have or try to respond to questions from the public.
I think we'll launch into the public hearing, and I know Councilor Barry has a question. The town's attorney will be available right here to rise and answer any questions directed to him. I would like to open the public hearing on this issue. Now, this is an issue, I would tell the listening audience and the audience here, that this is an issue that the council has been really talking about for several weeks, maybe months.
Months.
And we've given it a lot of thought, and we have had workshops on it before, and we've had a lot of people who've given us their opinions and interpreted this, and how it's happening in other parts of the states and in other towns. So we have really worked on it, and this is our time to vote on it. But before we need to do that, this is the best time to have public opinion. I don't think, I mean, I spoke today, and I myself had not clearly made a decision yet on this. So if there's anybody there who wishes to speak on this issue from the public, please come forward. Seeing none, I will declare this public hearing closed, and we will now go to council decision. Let's have some discussion. Councilor Barry.
Madam Chairman, I'd like to know if a study has been made as to the number of properties that would be affected by this change in the zoning ordinance.
I don't know the answer to that. Not a question that's been asked, so I'm not sure that I know. If it, you want to know if a study's been done of properties that it would have...
That would be affected by this proposed change in this...
Like the number of houses that are in the streets that are not in shoreline zoning?
Right.
Well, I don't know. I have to count all the... I don't know.
Councilor Barry, we do not know the number of non-conforming structures that there are in the town of Cape Elizabeth. It's probably in the hundreds.
Yes.
Particularly in the IRA zone, where we require 80,000 square foot lots now, whereas in earlier days it was 40,000.
Right. Councilor Fritz.
I strongly feel that that's something that we have lacked in our study of this issue. I think we've looked at some interpretation and we've looked at requests that have come before the planning board or the zoning board for a 2 or 3 year, I think it was a 2.5 year period. I don't think that was enough statistics to prove that we've had either a substantial increase over past requests before the board. I think we need to look at a longer time period. But also, I really do think we need to look at how many people would be affected and how they would be affected. Because it's not only the people who come for requests to make changes and add a structure or portion to their house, it's the people who live next door, who have purchased a property, who make an assumption that there's a 25-foot setback and that that's the way it'll be. And there will be a certain buffer between their house and their neighbors, and the rules will apply. And I think we need to look at how many people will be affected. I think we did this some years ago when we went into the shoreland zoning. There was an actual looking at aerial photos. I'm not sure what all the records are that you look at, but just how many people would be affected by the setback. And a decision was made not to go forward on something. So I think that's a very good point, Councilor.
Thank you.
Other discussion? Yes, Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I just had a question. In the memo in our packet that was dated January 3rd, it referenced a non-conformance chart. And I remember in our workshop we talked about precluding that, and it is not here. But I just want to raise the question again. What we're voting on tonight does not include the non-conformance chart. Is that correct?
That's correct. The council at an earlier date decided that it no longer wanted to consider that chart as part of its action, because that chart actually changed some setbacks and put that aside. It was not, the chart was not set for public hearing.
Okay.
With the exception of the minimum 10 foot.
That's in this document.
Yeah.
Yes.
Madam Chair, could the town attorney tell us whether or not there have been any cases involving litigation on this new zoning standard?
No, I'm not aware of any, certainly not any Maine Supreme Judicial Court cases on it, and I'm unaware of any at the superior level either. And if I may comment on the study of what, how many houses or residences may be affected by this, it would, since variances aren't allowed for lot area or street frontage, it really is a setback issue, and it would have to be measurements made on each individual house. It wouldn't be like looking at the tax map and seeing which lots are undersized lots, because that just having an undersized lot doesn't mean that this would apply to them. You'd have to physically go to each residence and measure the distance between the sideline and the house to know whether you're going to run into a problem. So it's a lot more intensive than looking at tax maps and counting how many lots are undersized lots, because that's really not going to tell you whether a particular building is going to be affected by this or not.
Further amplifying it, there was one case where a city used the practical difficulty standard, their zoning board, to determine a case when the city had in fact not adopted the practical difficulty standard.
That's
so
true.
There was one case, but it was more of a side issue than a...
Correct, and they weren't allowed to read that into their ordinance because it hadn't been adopted.
Councilor Roberts?
I've obviously had some reservations about changing to this, but then again, I do like to think that we've got some pretty professional boards and commissions, and I want to support their recommendations wherever possible. I will be supporting this amendment tonight, or the change to the new definition. However, I would like to see a report come back to the council within 12 months, letting us know how many cases have been before them and what the disposition has been, and probably more importantly, what kind of a hue and cry is coming from the neighbors who are being affected. As a counselor, I have heard not one resident indicate that they thought this would be a problem. Every bit of feedback I've had is from people that want it. The zoning board wants it. We've spoken with the town attorney in workshop. He's convinced that it's workable, so I guess for those reasons, I'm willing to support it, but I would like to have a report back in a year on where we stand and whether it is working.
Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
I'd like to concur with Councilor Roberts. I think, as we all know, the council appoints the zoning board. The zoning board feels at this point what they've communicated to us is that their hands are, in essence, tied. There's really no option for them to give variances now. I think it would be easy for us to say no, but it wouldn't be the right thing to do. I've heard from a few more than a dozen people on this issue, and no one has been against the change. They have all been in favor of the change. I think we can't ask the zoning board to violate the rules by not applying this consistently, so I will be voting yes for the new practical difficulty standard. And this is not an irrevocable decision. If we get the numbers back a year from now and hear that things are going badly, we can revisit the decision and change it back. So I think the reasonable thing to do is to vote for it.
Yes.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to make one other point regarding Councilwoman Fritz's comment on the abutting property owners wanting to rely on what the zoning ordinance is, and I think that's a good point. I just wanted to point out that the section in the, and this is really a policy decision, I'm not arguing for or against, but I just wanted to point out that that section of the proposed language which gives an abutting property owner standing to show that the change, the variance request, would unreasonably detrimentally affect the use or market value of their property. That standard isn't in the ordinance right now. So if someone came in and a variance application met the criteria, but it was going to cause harm to the abutter, the zoning board is not, under current law, to look at the effect on the abutter. They look at the standards of the undue hardship. So in some ways, and I think it was to counterbalance the relaxation of the standards, but in some ways, it does give abutting property owners more protection. And I say that guardedly, because probably the best protection for abutting property owners is the undue hardship standards. So, but I did want to just point out that it does have that language in there, as you probably were already aware, but it does give the abutting property owners an ability to voice their concerns and how it will affect them.
Yes. Councilor McGinty.
This is an issue that I've been sitting on the fence on, something I usually don't do, but I've sat in on several zoning board meetings. I see board member Backer is here tonight, and the board really agonizes over these issues, because if they really follow the current ordinance, it's seldom, if ever, they could really grant the variance the way it's based now. And I think with all the checks and balances, if you will, as Mr. Hill has indicated, are in the new ordinance, that I think we should give them the opportunity to make some decisions. If we don't like the decisions they make, as Ann has indicated, we can get rid of them. And I also agree with...
get rid of the decisions, you mean, not the people.
Or both. We can get rid of them. One way or another, maybe. And we can always change it back if it's not working. And I would concur with Jack that we should request a report in 12 months to see exactly how it is working and see what the outcome is. So I've agonized over this myself, but I will be supporting the change.
Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I keep going back to one of our workshop meetings where the past chairman of the zoning board spoke to us about, you know, the difficulty of undue hardship, and came away from that meeting saying that we basically had tied their hands. And a couple of years ago, we gave them the directive that said, this is the zoning rules, we expect you to follow them, and if that means not granting any, don't do it. But if you find that there's a problem and that there is an area of concern that needs to be addressed, that we need to go back as a town and look at that change, that we request that you come before us. And I think that's exactly what they're doing. So I have had some concerns. I was hoping we'd have some people speak tonight to help me get off the fence too and make a decision. But you know, when push comes to shove, I will be supporting this. I think our attorney has spoken very well about the new changes that I think add some teeth to this that make me feel a lot more comfortable, and more comfortable than I did when I was in the workshop, understanding that some of these items that have to be met or can be brought up as obstacles are new to the zoning. And so therefore, my comfort level has risen significantly, and I will support this. With all the caveats of, in 12 months, let's take another look and see how many variance opportunities have come before us and what public comment or abutters comments have been. Thank you.
Councilor Fritz.
I think it sounds good to say we'll change the definition and look at it again next year, but I don't think that that's necessarily fair to people who come afterwards to keep changing the rules all the time. I think we ought to know well what we're doing, have the facts behind us, and be very confident in what we're changing, and then stick with it. I agree that the definition of undue hardship is very strict. I think a lot of what we've been wrestling with is that the practical difficulty has a real leniency about it in the definition, but the legislature only gives us two choices. It doesn't seem to me a good policy to adopt one we're not liking, that only, I think, one or two other towns have adopted. Some other towns have looked at it, but nobody's taken it on. It hasn't been tested in court. I would rather send our representatives and senators off to Augusta with a better definition, something that's in between, something that's more moderate, that we can live with better, that continues to maintain the kind of character we want in our neighborhoods. After all, our ordinance, the purpose of our ordinance is to prevent overcrowding. That's what it says. All the ordinances within that zoning ordinance, every regulation ought to fulfill that mission. And I think this opens up for setbacks of only 10 feet on a property side, so 20 feet, where, as opposed to these neighborhoods having 25-foot setback and 50 feet. That's a big difference to me, and it means a potential overcrowding of our neighborhoods, and many of our neighborhoods. I also think that although these definitions sound good, like not having harm on the market value, the abutting property owner needs to make the argument then when it comes before the planning board or the zoning board, and I don't think that's always easy to make. And I think many people don't want to speak up against their neighbor. They want to get along with their neighbor. I've been in that situation myself. So I think we're jumping into this. I think it's not a good ordinance to follow our comprehensive plan.
I appreciate Councilor Fritz's comments. She's had a lot of experience, having been on the board and some of these boards and been on the ordinance committee. And I think you make some very valid points. I think one of the things that is of concern is that we have one set of rules in place, now we're going to put new sets of rules in place, and now we're going to say, but we might change those rules in a year, and that's a difficult policy for people. On the other hand, I do think that given the recommendations of our very hardworking and experienced zoning board, that I am willing to give this a shot. I don't think the number of houses are that great. I think that we have some neighborhoods that are in the older parts of town, but the houses are already very close, and they're not going to be able to get that variance. So I also will support this, and I also will support it with a caveat that we have the ability to change this in a year. I don't, however, I have to say, admittedly, I'm not sure that this is the best public policy, the way of carrying out public policy. But I think I'd give it a fair shot. Councilor McGinty.
I'm not suggesting that we change it in a year, but I think it is good public policy to, from time to time, review our ordinances, mm-hmm. all our ordinances, and make sure that they're doing what they mean to do. If this thing turns out to be a disaster, I don't think any town councilor would want to leave it on the books if it's turning into a complete mess. But if it's working fine, then that will be the policy until the next council changes it sometime.
I suppose it's a little scary when we think it's a disaster and now in those few houses it's already happened, you know, so that's
presumably by voting for this we're assuming that's not going to happen.
Yeah, I guess. All right. Are there any more comments? Is anyone willing to call a question? We need a motion.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I'd like to move that we approve the proposed amendments, the practical difficulty practical difficulty standard for the zoning ordinance as described in the January 3rd, 2000 memo.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Councilor Barry.
I agree with Councilor Fitz. I think the legislature ought to be presented with an opportunity to change the definition. Too many people on the fence here.
Okay. All those in favor for the motion? Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3, 4. All those opposed? Thank you very much. We're going to move on to item number 20, which is also a public hearing. This is also an issue that the town council has had some workshop on, some written material over the past several weeks. Months?
Yes.
Years? And I'd like to open that public hearing. This is a public hearing in action upon proposed changes for rescue services in Cape Elizabeth, including the establishment of fees. I'll ask the manager to give us an overview, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. This issue has been around Cape Elizabeth as long as I've been around Cape Elizabeth, over 20 years, and a number of issues relating to this. What level of service should we be providing rescue services to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth? Should the rescue members get paid? Should the rescue be self-supporting? and similar related issues. I can remember attending, you know, several rescue meetings over the last decade at which some of these issues have been discussed. Up until about 3 years ago, the rescue always took the position, no, we don't want to be paid. You know, we're doing an excellent job, and everyone agreed, they still agree that they're doing an excellent job. But about 2 years ago, the council had gotten a number of phone calls from council members saying that, you know, perhaps that we weren't providing care to the level that we should. And there was some interest in the council at stepping in and making some changes in the rescue unit. I think the council showed true leadership in deciding that the rescue company itself ought to be in the forefront of determining what the future of the rescue should be. So the council established a goal 2 years ago this month, saying and requesting the rescue company to develop a strategic plan for the rescue. Subsequent to that, Neil Allen, a facilitator, was brought in, who's the executive director of the Greater Portland Council of Governments. I might add, at no expense to the town of Cape Elizabeth, all those services were donated by COG. He met for over a year, off and on, with the rescue, also met with Southern Maine EMS representatives, representatives of Maine Medical Center and Mercy Hospital, with former rescue members, as well as with the head of the Viking here in Cape Elizabeth Long-Term Care Facility. Subsequent to all the discussions of the rescue, a report was issued on October 28, 1999, at which point the rescue itself set forth a strategic direction with certain findings and strategies. That came to the town council, and the town council asked me in December of 1999 to come up with an implementation plan for that strategic direction. That ultimately was submitted to the council on March 1st, and I did not depart, I don't believe, in any instance at that point from what the rescue had recommended. I was reluctant to make any suggested changes because this had truly come about because of the consensus of the people who directly provide the service and work at it day to day. The recommendations that I made basically were looking at what the pay levels ought to be for rescue members, for call company personnel proposed, similar to what the fire department is, what the fees should be, how those fees should be collected, and particularly how we might enhance paramedic services, since that was indicated in the report as a desire of the rescue to provide that higher level of care. We looked at other towns, what they do. You see all that in the report. We've also, particularly through the fire chief, have discussed with a number of different communities options for looking at how we might collect any revenue that might be, or fees that might be assessed. One of the real backdrops in all of this, though, has been the fact that we rely quite a bit on the city of South Portland for supplementing our paramedic service. To my knowledge, I think we only have one paramedic, still just one, who's Roz Flaherty, who does yeoman service or yeoman service in being a paramedic for the rescue service. You know, for a town of 9 or 10,000, whatever the census is going to say, to rely solely on one person to provide that level of care, you know, I think is asking an awful lot of that person. Particularly when you see the growth in rescue calls from when it first started about 40 years ago, at about 50 calls a year up to the current 500, not all of which are paramedic calls. I don't mean to mislead anyone. The number of issues that kept coming up, though, as this was being discussed, and that was, you know, what happens if South Portland no longer provides paramedic service? That is still a concern, and we've sort of strung South Portland along, and they've been very good working with us while we have been undergoing this study and while the town council is considering it. I want to publicly thank the city of South Portland for all of their efforts in supplementing the work of iRescue. It's really been great to have them. The second issue is what should be the level of pay for paramedics. My earlier proposal did not go over very well, and it was quite frankly weak. It obviously was intended to try to encourage folks to participate as paramedics and we heard very clearly from them afterward that it was not going to do the job. I've suggested in a cover memo to you, and this is, you know, something on the table, but I think we need to get forward doing it, is the paramedics transporting a patient to the hospital would receive $50 per call as an alternative to my original proposal, which was $10 an hour, which just would not be enough of an incentive. This has been a long, long process, 2 years, and it's involved an awful lot for the rescue. I had a meeting with the fire chief today, and you know, we were looking at, you know, what happens if this doesn't go forward after all this effort. And, you know, I'm not sure, to be honest, but I think we would have some issues with the city of South Portland. And I think when you look at the strategic direction of the rescue in terms of what their priorities have been, and that's to ensure that there's proper training, to ensure that particularly residents of the town expect to receive the best emergency care possible, you know, I'd really question whether or not we were doing that. So that's an introduction to the history of the report. The fees are based on Medicare. We do expect, there's been a number of questions, Councilor McGinty sent a couple of emails, and the fire chiefs looked at what our recovery might be. And, you know, we're basing it on the thought that it'll be 80%. That's not what everyone does. But from the ones that we have talked to recently, and the chief can elaborate on this, the exact communities he's spoken to, 80% does seem to be realistic on the fees that we will actually recover. But again, there's no guarantees, and I, you know, could be sitting here next year when if this is approved, when you review it a year from now, saying, Mike, what happened? The numbers didn't hold up. They may not, but, you know, if this is approved, we do believe that that will be the case. So I look forward, as you do, I'm sure, to hearing the public hearing comments and hearing the council's discussion on this issue.
Thank you, Michael. I think I'd just take a few comments to the listening citizens out there. I'm not sure if they really grasp what we're talking about. When we're talking about, this is before the public hearing begins, really. I just want the TV watching audience to know, when we're talking about fees for service, we're talking about billing and charging people costs for the rescue call. Just to give an idea, there would be a base rate for somebody when the rescue came to get them and take them to the hospital. There is a rate in our report to be used for various pieces of equipment, defibrillation equipment, monitor equipment. There would be a rate assigned for IV therapy or oxygen or intubation. All of these things that might happen to you as a citizen would then be charged fees for those services. I just didn't know if people watching there really understood when we're talking about fees for services, but we are going to let members of the public speak on each issue. And looking over the report that came from the that came to us, there seemed to be four areas, and I think Michael spoke about them, but I want to be sure that the listening audience, in case the telephone should jingle out there, that was fees for service. I hope you understand that now. And the pay for rescue members who make voluntary calls, who leave their homes, who come out at all hours of the day and night to make their rescue calls. This is paying them a fee for those calls, just as we now pay firemen or firepersons for that. And the
Firefighters,
right. And the issue that really started this rolling for the council was the recommendation that we need more paramedics available to make calls. I want the public to understand that there is a, and I may be wrong, so please correct me, but if they're watching, that there are at this time three levels. There's the EMT level, there's the intermediate level, which is a step up more in hours, and then there's the paramedic level. They're all licensed rescue people, and they are at different levels. There are occasionally times in any community when a rescue call is made that you need to step up to a different level depending on what services you are going to provide for the patient. So this came to us as the council, the fact that there are times that we need to have more paramedics available, and that being the case, how would we get them in our community to support our needs? So the four issues that we as a council that came in our report tonight will be fees for service, pay for rescue members, paramedics issue, and the last issue is that we've had an ongoing experience with the town of South Portland. As many citizens know,
most of the communities in Maine, or in southern Maine certainly, are what they call mutual aid communities, and that if South Portland were to have a multiple catastrophe, or that their rescue vehicles would be out, our rescue people would go sit in their stations to support their calls. And this is true for fire, and I guess police. We are mutual aid communities, so not only does South Portland help us, but we are, on occasion, have an opportunity to help South Portland out. But that the community of South Portland is looking for us to make some decision. We call South Portland mostly to support our need for when we think we need a paramedic. They have full-time paramedics on duty. And we have statistics in our documents here that tell us the number of times that a paramedic would be requested as the highest licensure above an EMT or an intermediate. So those are the four issues that we are directed to in our communication. And now I just hope that that's a little information, if I was right on it all, for the public that's watching on TV. And now I'd like to open this public hearing to members of the citizenry that are here. And please, when you have any comments to make, you're helping us, remember, come to some sort of a decision, so just inform us. And please come to the podium so you can be heard by the TV audience as well. Thank you. Now, anyone wish to comment on this item? I love it. 50 people.
My name is Patrick Cotter. I live at 21 Ocean House Road here in town. Member of Engine 1 Company and also Engine 3 Company, where I serve as basic EMT. I'm going to talk in two different sections here. The first is a paramedic coverage. Everyone in town deserves to have that level of service. This town pays enough in property taxes where we deserve to have that service. And in my opinion, it's really unfair to the citizens of South Portland for us to call in and have a paramedic come to our town when I know if I was a citizen of South Portland and one of my family members had a heart attack or needed an albuterol treatment, which is a treatment for breathing disorders, to say, sorry, we don't have a paramedic available, or Rescue 2 has to come all the way over from Cache Corner to Ferry Village, you know, where it's just a, I don't know, 10-minute run, lights the siren, somewhere around there. It's also unfair to the EMTs that put themselves on the line different times of night, different times of day, leave work, drop what they're doing at home, to sit there and see a person fading away or see somebody that could really use the paramedic services and to call for them and say, and the dispatcher come back to you and say, sorry, there's none available. It's kind of a sinking feeling. Luckily, it's only happened to me twice, but your options are pretty limited. As an EMT, B, I'm basically trained to stabilize patients. The only drug I can give is oxygen. And basically the only other option I have if I need to get you to the hospital is to turn the lights and siren on and drive as fast as we possibly can, get you there as fast as we possibly can. What people don't understand as far as paramedics, I'm going to SMTC as a paramedicine student right now, and what you don't understand is the amount of hours. It's an 1,800-hour course to become a paramedic. So you are going, I have skills here that I know what's going on with. A paramedic has skills up here. So it's not just as I'm looking at you and you have a breathing problem. I know you have a breathing problem. You have stuff in your lungs, things like that. A paramedic knows what to do. They can directly affect the patient care right there and get the person there much more comfortably. That's breathing disorders is a bulk of will be a bulk of our paramedic calls if we ever get paramedic service or better paramedic service. We have it now. Where paramedics are really going to help is when what we call is a code layman's term is a heart attack, where basically someone's heart stops beating and they stop breathing. I can't give life-saving drugs now. All I can do is put a BBM on you and ventilate you and do CPR. That's all I can do. Intermediate can start a line, can intubate somebody, and can put them on the monitor just to see that they don't have a heartbeat. A paramedic can directly affect with the cardiac drugs that the state of Maine, the state EMS allows, directly affect the outcome of that person's life. Basically, because the sooner we get the heart beating, the better chance that person has for a speedier recovery and a better recovery. We're lucky here in this town, lights and sirens, we can probably get you from the farthest point away in town to Maine Medical Center in about 4 or 5 minutes. We're very lucky in that.
The bridge isn't up.
But the bridge isn't up, you're right. So what I'm saying is, I'm a firm believer that everyone in this town needs a paramedic, not all the calls. You know, if you break your arm, taking the same person to the hospital the 19th time for the same thing, don't need a paramedic. But there are those cases, and I personally believe they're about 30%, that we do need a paramedic. And I think it's only fair to the men and women that volunteer on the rescue and the fire department, because the fire department backs up the rescue, that that you, the town council, supply us with that. Moving on to the charging, anyone that's in the medical field knows how expensive everything is as far as medical equipment. South Portland just bought 2 new rescues, which are pretty much like our Rescue 1. They were around $107,000. They got a deal because they bought 2. Ours won't be that cheap. We have a life pack in Rescue 1 that ran us about $12,000, right? 1,200? 14. These are some things that we need to keep updating. And not just to mention the medical supplies, and also our training. Right now, even a basic EMT course is going for about $400. And we need to somehow recover that cost. And I think the town should somehow recover that cost. The insurance companies are willing to pay. This is not something that we're saying when we go to the hospital, here, we're giving you a bill right now. The insurance companies are willing to pay this. This is an open check. They don't question it. You send them the bill, they send you the check. It's quick. And like you were saying, the recovery is about 80% here in the state of Maine. That's about all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anybody else like to speak on these issues?
Hello. My name is Greg Toot. I live at 40 Highview Road. Soon to be 17, Highview Road, whenever that takes place. I've been on the rescue for about 7 years now, and my comments tonight are my opinions and observations, but hopefully will help you ask questions about what we do and what the town needs to make your own decisions. My opinion is that the current rescue provides high-quality, reliable service, and that we're fortunate to be here discussing ways to enhance our service as opposed to reacting to incidents that would put this in a whole different light. I think this has been a proactive process, and I do think we need to implement some of the strategies involved in this process for a couple reasons, particularly the recruitment and retention of members, and also so that we can continue a sense of community service that the rescue right now provides. I have several items that I'd like to discuss. First is, when we met last and I had an opportunity to be at the town council workshop, my understanding was that the proposal would be presented in the three or four topics that Mrs. Carson outlined, in that we would look at the recruitment of paramedics, which is absolutely an important piece of this proposal, and thankfully we have at least four or five here tonight, so at least we sparked some interest. And I think all of these items have different levels of urgency. The other two levels that I had, or the other two items that I was thinking about were paying rescue members for their calls, which again I believe has some retention and recruitment value, and then the last would be looking at fee-for-service, which I believe is probably best left up to the town council now to decide how the budget is spent in Cape Elizabeth, and we certainly have the confidence that, you would provide the funding that we need. The next is looking at the rescue from the eyes of the rescue company, the town council, and the community, and the role that the rescue is supposed to play in this community, and what are the standards for emergency medical services in other communities, and are those standards okay for Cape Elizabeth? Should we be looking at enhancing the role of the rescue, or should we be looking at making sure that we have a plan for the future, which obviously that's why we're here, and will that plan be effective a year from now, 5 years from now, or 10 years from now, and how do we set out that strategic plan to make that happen? I think the basic structure of the rescue works for the town right now, and I think it works quite well. And again, I think we're talking about a small percentage of the rescue calls, which get a large percentage of the attention, and it is appropriate because it's an extremely valuable service that we provide to the town. We may only see 400 citizens a year if you take out visitors and repeat people. And out of 8,000, it's not a lot, but to every one of those 400, it's the most important thing going on at that time. I would also stress that we do have a full spectrum of licenses on the rescue, and that we need to continue to match appropriateness of the community need with appropriateness of license level. And quality, in my opinion, does not equal license level. There is no evidence that a basic EMT cannot do an assessment as well as a paramedic. What happens then is the decision tree changes to how you would treat the patient. So I think it's very important to understand that we have basic EMTs and intermediate EMTs who make wonderful assessments, make great decisions, and do save lives all the time. Third, I would also ask you that after 2 years, to look at the impact of your decision tonight, or lack of a decision tonight. If you don't make a decision, will it dramatically change the service of the rescue as it's provided tomorrow morning? Probably not. Is it important that some action is taken so that we can again look forward to the future in a relatively short time frame? Yes, absolutely. But I cannot stand here and tell you that it's imperative that you make a decision or else, because I don't believe that. And finally, I'm optimistic that these plans are going to work. I have felt very active in the process, and I think the town has gone about it in a very proactive way. And my only concern is that we continue to build on the existing program and department that we have in place, and I think we can enhance the services that we provide and make that appropriate to the community's needs. And paid or not, we're still volunteers, and I think we will be here as long as the town needs us. And lastly, my guess was 37% on collection, so hopefully we'll fall somewhere in the middle. Thank you. Any questions I can answer for you?
Probably not right now. We'd like to hear from others. I think I would, just based on one comment that you made, is I just have a show of hands. How many paramedics are sitting out here in the audience? Now can I have a show of hands? How many happen to reside? You may work someplace else, but how many happen to reside in Cape Elizabeth? And how many happen to reside in, let's say, this end of South Portland? Or okay, so you're all fairly close to us. Okay, thank you. Now, more comments, please.
I live on Ocean House Road. I was here for the workshop. I work in South Portland. I'm one of the people that makes the decision on if we send you a paramedic. And for the last 6 months at officers' meetings, every officers' meeting we have, they ask me, has Cape done anything yet? And I keep saying, they're working on it, they're working on it. So I'm glad they're working on it tonight. I was with the rescue for a number of years as a paramedic, provided coverage for no charge. I didn't mind it, but my family life, kids, et cetera, dictated that I had to do other things. I've been in the field as a paramedic for 13 years, working in South Portland, and again, volunteering out here for the fire department. I'm here for two reasons. One, my concern from my relatives and family out here that we as a town need to come forward and provide the best possible level of service. I think in no way is that a criticism of the rescue. They do a dynamite job. They really do. I support the plan. I feel anybody willing to get out of bed for me at night to come down to my house if I'm not feeling well or someone in a car accident, whatever, deserves to be compensated if they want to be compensated. If they don't want to be compensated, they can donate the money back to the rescue or whatever they want to do. You framed the issues in several different ways. And I can debate the first two speakers in a couple of ways, and it's not a criticism one way or the other. I look around at other communities. I teach for Southern Maine Technical College in the paramedic program, and I see what we're putting out for students. Some of the students, I don't know if it was Pat or Greg, went like this. Some are up here, some are down here. That's no different than if you go to medical school or you go to become a plumber. There's some very good plumbers, there's some very shoddy plumbers. And what I offer that a paramedic also would do for this service would help them train a little bit better. The good paramedics that I teach, and the one thing you get out of my class is the better paramedics not only know when to push medications, they know when not to. And part of your assessment is maybe saying, you know, the best thing for this patient is to throw them in the truck and drive fast. That's okay. But there are also times when you have to use your skills. And people can go up and argue and say, well, these two skills you only use once or twice, and can't debate it. Guy I work with, one of my past students, did a chest decompression the other day. You don't do them very often. I've done one in 13 years, but he did it. The lady's still alive. May it happen here? Maybe, maybe not. I think the report went a long ways in looking at, and the manager, or whoever wrote the report, I assume the manager, framed a lot of the issues really, really well in that the citizens expect the service when the truck pulls up. Doesn't matter if it's the compost site or a rescue showing up or the guy plowing our roads, we expect a pretty good service. We're getting a fairly good service. It's time to push the service a little bit. Let's push the good people we have, go a little bit further. Having some more paramedics around to help them maybe enhance their skills, not take over, but to enhance their skills, and also maybe to make a difference with a few patients along the way. People may want to argue about time on scene, response times, et cetera. I'll give you one example. I was working about 3 years ago. The police department had a guy supposedly having a heart attack down in the Kettle Cove area. We left Central Fire Station on Rescue 1. We went by this station. The police officer was there doing what he should be doing, had the AED on, trying to ventilate the person or whatever. We beat their rescuing. Not a big deal. We happened to be sitting in the truck, so we obviously had a minute or two. My assessment skills allowed me to haul a piece of chicken out of this guy's throat about this spot, this bit. He wasn't having a heart attack. He was choking. That's just one example of different assessment skills. And by some of the people you have currently employed on the rescue, working with a few other people that have some experience, a lot of experience. You can come out of EMT class with 110 hours training and you've never been on a call, it's very difficult to expect a lot out of that person without having some calls under their belt. And we see it in South Portland. We may hire a new guy. We may hire one of these people next week. I can't really put them on the truck until I get some calls under their belt, see how they function under pressure. The fee schedule, I don't have a problem with that. I don't mind paying for a service, and I think most of the citizens probably would feel the same way. So like I said, again, I support the plan wholeheartedly. It's a step in the direction to try to enhance what we already have. We have a good service, let's make it better. And if anyone comes up and says they don't strive to make the service a little bit better, I question their motives. Other communities around have all gone through this. We did it in South Portland about 10 years ago when Chief Mahula was there. We had no paramedics. He came out and challenged a bunch of us that were young at the time, 22, 23 year olds, you know, 10 and 12, 13 years ago, and said, hey, let's go get trained. We kind of went, well, and we did. And now we've got paramedics falling off the trucks. So we have paramedics on every truck down there.
I got a place for them.
Yeah. It's taken another 13 years and a lot of arm twisting to get there. We've kicked a lot of the old school. We went from having probably three or four EMS licenses that we probably have two or three guys now that don't. Everybody has one. And it's just, it's the wave of the future in the fire service. Like I said, again, everybody does a very good job. We have a good service. I think we should be making it better. And I think this plan goes a long way in the beginning of that process. Thanks.
Good question.
Yes.
Just how many hours for an intermediate?
120.
No, that's a basic. It's another, about another 100.
Oh, 40.
So 110 for EFT.
For a basic, yeah.
And then a couple of hundred for...
Oh, 200 for all
basic. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dan Brown. I live at 258 Mitchell Road, soon to be 2 Brownstone Lane. Until about 2.5 years ago, I was one of 2 paramedics in the Cape Elizabeth Rescue. I joined the rescue in 1975 and served as the captain in 1995 and as a lieutenant for most of the other years. I have been a professional paramedic for almost 20 years. The present council plan, I'll speak of this personally, my feelings. I'm not going to rehash the need. I feel there is a need, but I'm not going to rehash all the reasons. The present plan to me feels like volunteerism. About 4 or 5 years ago, I decided that I could no longer serve as a volunteer. So I think my point is we need to address the issue of the paramedic as a medical professional to be employed and not on a piecemeal basis. We don't expect police officers to be paid on a call basis, which they go to, or nurses aren't expected to be paid on the number of patients they treat. The trend is for EMS coverage, is for pay on a shift basis. Following towns, and this is only a partial list, a brief list, following towns pay either full-time for full-time EMS coverage or on pay on a per-shift basis. Old Orchard, Westbrook, Cumberland, York, Wells, Ogunquit, Scarborough, Naples, Yarmouth, Portland, South Portland, Poland, Freeport, Gorham, Windham, Gray, Waterboro, and there's many others. Personally, I'm not interested in carrying a pager on a basis of maybe having it turned on 2 hours at a time and I'm around not doing anything. If I have something else going on, I'm going to take off and do it. On the other hand, I will commit myself on a time basis, on a shift basis, if you will. That's a commitment to me that I make to myself and to the town. And I would expect to be paid on that basis. Billing. I think I would suggest that we not do a phase-in on the billing. That was initially suggested. I don't see any reason to do a phase-in billing. I think you should just do it the whole thing. You'd just be losing potential monies. I don't see the downside of phase-in billing myself. The impact on insurance companies would be nil. Some of the proposed fees that I read in the plan are, I think, quite on the low side. I have current figures on hourly rates, hourly pay rates for paramedics, and current billing information, which is a little more updated than came from the manager 7 months ago. Consequently, I think the present proposals need more work. One little point, mutual aid was mentioned. Mutual aid infers that Cape Elizabeth will return a similar service. By definition, mutual, that's not possible presently. So it's a very one-sided service at the time.
Dan, can you possibly leave that list of towns and stuff with the chairman? Thank you.
Yeah. What was the question? I did want to hold off on questions till the public hearing.
Just asked if Dan would leave that list later for us.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, may I have other comments, please? The council can call on any one person back after.
Good evening. I came here not expecting to speak, but you asked that part of this would be information to you, and
absolutely.
I think that's what I can help provide. My name is George Higgins. I reside at Stonegate neighborhood. I'm Chief of Emergency Services at Maine Medical Center. I have been involved with the rescue unit here for years, and certainly are involved with all of the paramedic teams in our community. I want to make a few comments to help you in your deliberations, and this is really meant to help inform you to make better informed decisions. There are only two at this point in time proven, clearly evidence-based proven outcomes from pre-hospital care, and that is defibrillating ventricular fibrillation. And that is why we have these AEDs, the automatic external defibrillators. And in our town, and I think you can help me with this, but our police service carry those and are quite responding. So that has been a marvelous tool. It can be used by minimally trained people who have knowledge of that device. That saves more lives per year than anything else that we do. The second thing that saves lives, quite frankly, is getting patients as quickly as possible to the definitive care facility, and that is the emergency department. And that, when I hear we have a 4-minute hot run to the main medical center or Mercy, that warms my heart. And I think that we're lucky to have that. All else, however, is being studied, and we have no good outcome science that anything that we do helps, although we have to assume that some of the things that we do probably do. A recent study suggested, for instance, in Los Angeles, that children pre-hospitally who collapse are do better if they're just bag valve masked with a bag rather than intubated, which requires a lot more skill. And so things that we think should work don't always prove to be true. The other thing that I want you to know is paramedicine to me is like emergency medicine in that we always dwell on illness and injury. And I would ask you to start thinking, and those in the audience to start thinking, of how to turn paramedicine into wellness rather than illness. And if you start thinking in those terms, there are all sorts of things you can start imagining happening with good trained people. And it isn't responding. Right now with 500 calls a year, many of them not requiring paramedic skills, but let's assume that we respond to all, that's 1.5 calls per day on average. That's 1.5 calls per 24 hours on average. So let's think about what we could do with the rest of those 24 hours in our town, in Cape Elizabeth. We could do immunizations. We could do home visits. We could do carbon monoxide detector checks. We could make sure the batteries and smoke detectors are up to snuff. We could ensure that the elderly have a medication check. We could ensure that the Viking nursing home has some type of immunization program. We could be getting our kids into helmets on their bicycles. We could be doing blood pressure clinics. We could be doing a number of things that might, quite frankly, benefit the health of this community much more than 1.5 runs per day. And if we're going to get into this business of paramedicine, I think we need to think about how to use these skilled people in ways that reflect wellness and not just illness. Secondly, I will tell you that the aging population uses EMT's services and paramedic services more than young people. And I think we look around at myself and others, we're an aging population, and I believe that we're going to have the expectation in our community that there will be responses. People don't do well at home, no matter how well prepared. Death at home does not do well, no matter how well prepared. You might have the best advanced will, and yet when the final moment comes, you want somebody in the home with you who understands this process. And I think paramedics can help us with that. Are there things in our community that we're doing now that could offset this if we're going to invest money into this? Are there things that paramedicine could do that other services now are outsourced for? I don't know the answers to that. So I think it's appropriate to charge Medicare, usually, for the services that we provide. I think it's very reasonable to compensate these folks for what they do. We might even think about not an all or none, but perhaps we look at our highest volume of calls and staff for those and then ask South Portland to help us at other times and pay them for their time that they provide to us, which I think might be beneficial. So I don't have the Solomon-type wisdom tonight to give you your decision, but I think that if we're going into this, one could look at staffing 24 hours a day with a paramedic that sits in the station most of the time, or we could think of more creative and perhaps more beneficial ways of using that skill if we're going to invest in it as a community. So I want to end by saying that I think the Cape Rescue does an incredible job, And I think that by elevating the quality of people, we could continue to serve our community very, very well. Thanks.
Thank you. Other comments, please?
Just briefly clarify a point. I've heard it referenced, someone can still be coming to the microphone while I'm saying this. I've heard it referenced that we can get to the hospital from the furthest point in Cape Elizabeth in 4 to 5 minutes. I did a quick calculation, and that's between 100 and 120 miles per hour. So I wouldn't feel too assured that that will be happening.
Yes, Mr. Groton.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the council. My name is Dick Groton, and I have served in Cape Elizabeth Rescue for something in excess of 20 years. I was going to correct that one issue that was raised earlier, that we could get to the hospital in 4 or 5 minutes, but I vowed coming up that I would not discuss any of the questionable statements that had already been made prior to my visit. It takes considerably longer than that. I guess I stepped to the microphone this evening to talk about just two or three things that are important to me. Having spent 20 years of rescue service in Cape Elizabeth, as we wind down our time and as we get older and it's a young person's business, there are certain things that I would like to see changed, of course, but there are more things that I would like to see remain unchanged. And those are a willingness to serve just because it's needed, not because you're paid to do it. I would like to see and have our town citizens and visitors to Cape Elizabeth experience having people respond because they simply care about them, having neighbor serving neighbor, as opposed to someone who is paid to respond to live up to their obligation. We have done that for a very long time, and it's nice to be able to say, no, ma'am, we don't get paid, we're all volunteer, we're here because we care about your needs this evening. What day is today? How do you feel? Where does it hurt? What can we do for you? Well, you call the rescue. Remember calling the rescue. We let in the cat. We let out the dog. We take the food off the stove. We turn off the oven. We put the booties on the feet because the feet are cold. We do all those things because we care. We do all those things not because they're particularly important to the health of the patient, but they sure are important to the well-being of the patient. If there is anything that we can teach new EMTs beyond the fact that they have to go on lots of calls to have the experience required to do it well, something that folks here this evening who have spoken earlier will find, the more you do it, the more comfortable you will be by being placed in those circumstances where you have to use those assessment skills to first determine what is happening here, what is the overall picture. And while you're deciding that, keep the ball rolling, keep patient assessment ongoing while the stretcher is coming in, while the patient's being loaded, while we're going to the rescue, while we're getting the wheels turning. I am a firm believer in George's school of get the wheels turning, get the patient moving closer to the hospital. So I don't want to lose sight of two or three things. The spirit of volunteerism and caring, moving the wheels, getting the patient loaded, not waiting for services that are external to come to us, get the wheels rolling, get moving to the hospital. If we would just do those simple things and better, and constant basic training for our newer EMTs, so that we're bringing their skills up fast. In my opinion, opinions have been given here this evening, probably 10%, 15% of the calls that we go on, or 50, 60, 70 of those 500 calls we've talked about earlier, really are true emergencies where intervention by a paramedic can not only bring comfort and aid to the EMTs, they don't need it. It might make them feel better to have the higher license there to take over, so they don't have the responsibility any longer. But those skills having a difference in the outcome of the patient's well-being, maybe 50 times a year, it makes a difference. Whether or not a patient gets an IV started in the field as opposed to 8 or 9 minutes later in the ER, does it make a big difference? Maybe. But you have to have the skills to assess the patient to find that out. Patients do shut down, veins do close. It does make a difference. But probably 50, 60, 70 of those 500 calls. So I couldn't agree with Dr. Higgins more than to say, if we bring paramedics to Cape Elizabeth, let's start it on a trial basis. Let's figure a way to do that. Let's study a little bit more and do a good plan. But if they're going to be here on anything remotely resembling a full-time basis, let's find a lot for them to do in a wellness situation. I've been captain of Cape Rescue. I've been in a training leadership role. I've been in a mentor role, and I'm standing to answer any questions you may have this evening as you move forward with your deliberations.
Thank you very much. It's so good to have you experienced people bringing comments to this council who's making this decision. So I hope others will come if they can add something to what's already been said. We're certainly looking forward to hearing whatever you have to say. Is there anybody else out there? Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Mark Stultz. I live at 416 Mitchell Road. I'm also serving as a lieutenant in the rescue. One of the things I might be able to add is I also work part-time for Westbrook Rescue, approximately 12 hours a week. So I get the best of both worlds. I get to work with paramedics in Westbrook, and I get to be a volunteer out here, and a lot of times I'm the highest licensed there. I've seen some cases where it definitely does make a difference. There are some certain things that happen out there that you cannot see being at the lower level. If somebody should have some type of problem in fall, especially in the elderly, there could be underlying reasons why they fell. Cardiac, for instance, whereas a basic EMT is not going to notice that, and it might not get picked up until they get to the hospital. I don't know if it's going to make a definitive difference in that, but the level of training is there. There are a lot of things that I see that happen out at Westbrook with the paramedics that they pick up on because of their increased training and their increased level of awareness. I think the citizens of Cape Elizabeth deserve that. How that comes about, I'm not sure. I've seen the pay scale as proposed, and I know from what they're getting in Westbrook that does fall short of what they're presently getting now, and they are due for a substantial increase. They're looking at their pay scales as well. Everything else that I've seen as far as the proposal, I think is on track, and I don't want to take up any more time, but that one area I think does need to be looked at, the staffing of paramedics or increasing paramedics in Cape Elizabeth and also the pay.
Thank you. Are there other comments?
Good evening. My name is Scott Maddox. I live at 481 Mitchell Road. And as far as I know, it's still going to be 481 Mitchell Road.
We wouldn't change that.
That's good. I'm sure you saw to that. I'm here tonight really quickly just to add my perspective. I've been a paramedic for about 8 years. The last couple of years, I've not been active. I was a former police officer for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I worked with the rescue, know most of the good people that are here tonight. I've been a resident of the town for about 10 years. I'm somewhat familiar with the situation. Something Mr. Grott said struck with me. When I started in EMS, I was a volunteer, and I really did enjoy that. It was very fulfilling. Just this last year or so, I've decided to try to get back into it a little bit to keep my skills working, and I've been in touch with some people on the rescue about trying to volunteer some time. As I worked out everything, and I'm just giving you this perspective because I'm one of the people that you might, I'm in that area that, of people that you're looking for as paramedics and residents. I worked out all the numbers and I just can't do it. I work 5 days a week. I work nights, actually 5 nights a week, and my days off, I'm often in Portland District Court, and I just felt that I would not be able to give a fair commitment. I don't believe in doing anything just kind of piecemeal, and so I've held back on doing that. I don't know whether or not volunteerism or paid service or some hybrid structure is the best for this town. I think each community is individual and has its own needs, and that's best left to the town council and the rescue service to decide what type of service suits them. But as a resident of this town and as a paramedic, I do feel strongly that we should have this type of service available to the town when it's needed. It may only be 10% or 15 or 30 or 5 or whatever percent it is where a paramedic makes an intervention difference, 50 calls a year. But those 50 calls are random. They could be at any time, at any place, day or night. And that's the problem with structuring a service that can respond to this type of thing. We don't know when a paramedic could be needed. If we did, we could schedule them for these 50 calls, and then the rest of the year we could have time off. So as a resident, I'm concerned that the council figures out some sort of way to provide this level of service. I have read over the proposal, and I must say that I do like it. It has piqued my interest, and I may reconsider my position. I don't know if paying paramedics 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to sit up the station, I don't know if that's the best plan either. I'm kind of somewhere in the middle. But I just wanted to offer my perspective of what I was thinking, and I'm encouraged by this meeting. I'm encouraged by the fact that the rescue is going to continue in its form and try to enhance itself and work with the town council to provide this service for the citizens of the town. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Are there other comments that could be made to add to our knowledge? This is a guy that should be able to add to our knowledge. You could find it down to a topic, though.
My wife says to be brief. She must be here. My name is Jim Murray. I reside at 1019 Sawyer Road. My comments tonight...
You moved?
Somebody said, making comments about my residence.
What is that, a pit?
The rock quarry.
That's what I thought.
My comments tonight are going to be brief. As I stated at the council workshop that I attended, and I got great respect for the paramedics, for the job they've done. I see Dan Brown one day under my leadership as captain of the rescue unit work on one of my employees that I give a million-to-one shot fall with massive head trauma, and it was unbelievable what he did, okay? So I support the paramedic level tremendously. But I also, like I stated at the workshop, I've got to take a real hard look at the intermediate level, which I understand now has changed, that the intermediates as of July 1, and quote me if I'm wrong, Kevin or Dan or whoever, can do almost as much as a paramedic with permission from the paramedic, a call to the paramedic, or a call to someone like Bud Higgins. I think we got to take a real good look at what we can do with our intermediates, which I understand we have 8 or 10 of them between the rescue company and Engine One company. So I think we got to take a real serious hard look at that situation, okay? The second thing is, I support volunteerism. I've been a volunteer in this town for 30 years in the fire service between the rescue unit and the fire department, and I think my pay is $3 a day before taxes, so I'm not here for the money. The second thing is the rescue unit has great respect from the taxpayers. As I stated at your workshop, you have never bought a rescue unit in this town since 1959 when it was incorporated. So if the situation goes that we start charging fees and we start getting paid, I have no problem with that, but you've got to take a look at what possibly could happen, okay? Right now, when we go for a fundraiser, the money pours in so fast you can't keep up with it. Seriously. I've been there many a times with the rescue units in fundraisers, and it just comes pouring in. It's unbelievable. And in closing, I'd just like to say that our rescue unit is one of the finest units, as far as I'm concerned, not because I've been there 30 years, but for the people who put in the time and do what they do, they are one tremendous organization. And I just want to remind the council that we are still a town, not a city. Thank you.
Is this a rebuttal?
Briefly, no. Just to clarify what Jim was talking about as far as the intermediate level, I am an intermediate, and I just went through the upgrade training that they have, and what he's referring to is 5 drugs that have been given to intermediates, basically for anything from respiratory, cardiac, also diabetics, and anaphylactic shock. The limitations that go along with that is, as it stands right now, we do have to call for medical control before we can administer any of those medications. And also, on the QI form, we are supposed to also be calling for a paramedic as well. So, right now, as it stands, those are the limitations that are stuck with that. There is the possibility sometime in the future that they may lift that limitation and allow intermediates to be able to have those drugs without response to the paramedic, but as it stands right now, that's the way EMS has it set up.
Thank you. Are there other comments that could inform us? You can lower that down, Evelyn.
My name's Evelyn Cox, and I'm the captain of the rescue. A speaker, I am not, which is why Greg took over for me. But I would like to thank everybody who has spoken tonight in support of the rescue and the town council for its consideration of what we're doing.
Okay. Thank you. Sounded fine. Are there other comments, please? Hearing none, I will declare this public hearing closed. We will now go into council discussion. Please don't go anywhere. I think there are questions among us. This has been something that we've given a lot of time to. With the exception of Councillor McGinty, there is nobody here that is a volunteer in the rescue. I don't think there's anyone here with the exception of Jack's son, who's a volunteer in the fire department. So we really want to make every effort to bring our knowledge up to speed. I think during the last couple of weeks, several of us have spoken to a variety of people that we thought could help us with information. And the problems before us to solve these are large, and we have commented to each other briefly, some of us, that the decisions we make about this issue are decisions that will be with this town for a very long time. So they are considered to be very, very important to us. And I would be certainly willing, after we've had our open discussion, I think each of us will, to give us a point of view. But there's one thing that on all changes like this, change is difficult for everybody, and it is so difficult for us, we want to be so careful not to destroy the soul of the rescue department and the soul of our community through its citizens that volunteer. So we really are taking this very seriously and hope we can make the right decisions for everybody. Now, let's see if we can open this up to public comments. I have notes on four or five pieces of paper here. Councilor McGinty.
Just one clarification, and Pat Cotter maybe alluded to this, maybe didn't mean to, but when he talked about the vehicle costing more money, and Jimmy kind of clarified that donations have bought the truck, that $14,000 12-lead EKG, that was bought by donations from the public. So and all the equipment, for the most part, is bought by donations from the public. And so I want to get clear that money is being spent from the rescue, from donations,
And obviously, it's not impacting the taxpayers at all for all that. Our last trip cost, I believe, about $90,000, as I recall, and that was all donated. So I want to clarify that. I don't think Pat meant to intimate that, but yeah, these things do cost money, but they're being paid for by donations from the public.
Thank you. Councilors, well, yes, Councilor Fritz.
I had a couple of questions for Dr. Higgins. I guess one of the things that we heard at the workshop was that if we had paramedics, we might be able to not have to train. They could do some things that might mean that we would not have to transport patients at all. And I was just wondering if that might be the case. And also just explaining the intermediate training a little bit more, whether we could really benefit and how much by more intermediate training rather than going to the paramedics at, say, now or immediately.
Let me take your first question, which was if we had paramedics, perhaps we'd not need to transport as many patients to hospital. I think that's indeed a true statement. The whole issue of non-transport has been a big and hot political one because there's always risk. And of course, what we're trying to do is keep people safe. And with now better training, better assessment, better tools, better skills, and better communication with us, and when you hear about medical control, that's nearly instantaneously available. We now can receive EKGs and so forth from the pre-hospital setting. I think that we are embarking on a time when many people can be treated safely and alternative manners of treatment can be devised so that they might go by private car, they might see their doctor the next day, etc. So I think that's developing, and I think we have a small enough community where we could potentially develop some of those. I consider those somewhat on the wellness side of things, education about when to call, what to do about B-bites or that sort of stuff. So that's the answer to your first question. I think that requires, however, judgment, experience, skills, assessment, and certainly the more training, the better for that. I must tell you that with my multiple hats that I wear now, that I'm not as close to the details of the intermediate, basic, and paramedic training. But the intent, as you just heard, is that to allow the intermediate to do things now with medical control that they never could do before, which means that in a very short period of time, in fact, I did this the last shift I worked, I approved medications through an intermediate just for a patient, and I believe that probably only a minute transpired in delay. So I think that is an option for us. I would look at the cost benefit of the next level up and experience. And you might even think of a paramedic as being the mentor and trainer and quality assurance officer to make sure your intermediates are doing a good job. And quite frankly, I would see the paramedic as bringing the student rescue people in a mentorship role so that we continue our volunteer influx of new people. Does that answer your questions?
Before we go on, I'd like to, so that the public is aware and so that the council remembers that throughout the several comments, there was some discussion about full-time paramedics being here full-time. That is not the issue that is before us this evening. We are not here to discuss full-time 24-hour service for paramedics because that issue is not brought to us. We are here, however, to discover a way of bringing paramedic skills available to us through our rescue service. But at this time, we are not talking about full-time 24-hour service, except as we contract on an individual basis, on a schedule, or on hours. Maybe just at this, to follow this, Evelyn Cox, could you explain to the rest of the council, because it's something I found out this week, more about the fact that you, in the evenings, for instance, our rescue people are on call, they have scheduled times where they have their beepers and they can respond. And I'm not asking you to make a judgment right now, but it's possible that we may be able to service our town with paramedics by having, if we can arrive at the right dollar amount, by having paramedics on scheduled times for responses.
Okay, at the present time, we have approximately 20 licensed EMTs who respond on an on-call basis. They carry a pager, and whoever's available goes. Sometimes we get five people, sometimes we get more, sometimes we get perhaps less. Between the hours of 10 p.m. and 6 a.m., we're on call. We have six night duty groups, and each of those group, each of the people on those groups is assigned a different night, rotating every sixth night, so that we know we have coverage from 10 p. to 6 a. Through the day, right now, it's an as-available basis.
But if we were to find a method among us here in this council of a way of whatever the financial cost is to bring paramedic skills available to us, if we had enough of them, they also could be on call, whether we pay them during their call time and also whether they pay them for a regular call. But we could schedule paramedic, we could provide ourselves with paramedic service by having enough of them on schedules if we made it financially.
Absolutely. If we had enough paramedics willing to do that, I think that's something that would have to be fine-tuned as we go along, whether they go on a schedule or whether they're on call. I think that's something that it's premature to even consider right now.
I want to underline that point that Captain Cox just made. You know, we have had some members of the public, some paramedics, suggest that we, in essence, do that. That, you know, as Dr. Higgins also indicated, you know, with only 50 calls a year currently estimated that you need paramedic, we're talking about one call a week. You know, that, in my mind, doesn't yet justify, even with all those extra things that Dr. Higgins indicated could happen, that we ought to be paying someone to be on call all the time. I think what the rescue proposed, in keeping with many of the other comments, the spirit of volunteerism, is that they, in essence, become a call company, much as the fire department is currently a call company. We still call it volunteer, but it's a call company with pay, that we transition the rescue to that same situation. And the paramedic portion, you know, we talk an awful lot about it, but really the only thing we're really doing in this proposal is offering some incentives for paramedics to respond to calls. We're not proposing to switch to a paramedic licensure level for the rescue, which is what some rescues have. There's a crucial difference in that. We're just simply trying, as the word's been used many times this evening, to enhance the quality of the rescue service, and looking somehow at what it might be, you know, if we do get, you know, that there are some opportunities for more paramedics, what it is that provides that incentive. You know, we come partway, but like, you know, same thing as practical difficulty and undue hardship, you got to see how it works for a while. But, you know, I think my sense is, in keeping with where the rescue was coming with volunteerism, that this call company proposal is in keeping with that. And if we went to having paramedics on duty for 8 hours, you know, I think the message we're hearing is they want more money than what the rescue gets for being on call, which even under this proposal, the night call group doesn't receive anything for being the night call group. They only get money if they respond to calls. And that's not what we're hearing from the professional paramedics.
Okay. Thank you. Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Cox. I'm sorry, I have a question for you.
Better sit up there next to Dr. Higgins.
As captain of the rescue, I'm sure you're much more in touch with what's going on amongst rescue members than I am. Could you tell me, do the majority of the rescue members support the proposed changes before us? Where is the group, if there is indeed a consensus? I've heard people get up and speak in favor of it, but I didn't know if that's a general consensus. And I understand that not everybody's going to feel exactly the same about everything, but what's your
I think
feel?
Everybody on the rescue at the present time feels that we need some paramedic coverage.
Okay.
How it's done remains to be seen. I think the pay issue, do you mean all three issues?
Yes.
I think the pay issue could go either way. And I would rather refrain from addressing the issue of fee for service because of my own personal feelings.
What are your personal feelings? If you don't mind saying.
My own personal feelings, as Chief McGoldrick and town manager have heard many, many times, is I hate to see it go fee for service. I think we're providing the town with a service now, and until that doesn't work, I personally would like to see that aspect of it stay the same.
And do you feel that's a common feeling amongst the rescue?
I can't speak for the rest of them.
Is there anyone else who can speak for the rescue? No, seriously, I'm not trying to put you on the spot.
I don't think for the most part that the rest of the rescue members, maybe it's split 50-50, but I don't think they would be at all concerned if we go fee for service.
Okay. They would not be concerned.
They would not be concerned. No.
Okay. Thank you.
If you go back to the original report, they recommended that it be phased in over time. It was very mild. It was not specific that they recommended that fees be in place.
I was just trying to get at, has there been a change of heart since the report?
I don't think anyone in their heart would like to see fees.
Of course, but I was going to say this is a business. This isn't a business, this is government, but somebody's going to have to pay for it. So, whether it's the insurance companies or whether it's the town and property taxpayers. So thank you very much.
Okay.
Evelyn, do you think, or Dr. Higgins, or anybody of your experience out there, do you think that, especially in a town where we have so many elderly phone calls, not only from the nursing homes, but from people who live in their own dwellings, that if we go for fee for service, that somebody will say, I can't afford to pay this right now, I don't want to call, I'll wait while I'm having trouble breathing, I'll wait and see if it goes away before I call. Do you think it will interfere with...
I don't
think
so.
No.
And I guess I would defer back to some of them with more experience than I, but I don't think it, especially those who have insurance, I don't think it will stop them from calling the rescue.
Do you think that there are people, enough people in our community who do not, elderly, who do not have? They have Medicare, so Medicare.
I think the Medicare patients, Medicare billing will go directly to Medicare, and the elderly may not even see a difference.
Okay. I didn't want anyone to be sitting in their house not calling rescue. Dr. Higgins?
In the large systems where this has been studied, these are not the Cape Elizabeths of the world. These
right.
are the Detroits, and clearly this is an issue, that when people feel they're going to be charged, they're reluctant to pay. And when they look at complaint categories, this would be one of the top complaint categories. Mm. Now, I would venture to say that most of our folks, the elderly, would be Medicare covered, but it's my experience that often the elderly don't understand insurance well.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, they can have 100% coverage, and yet the idea that they really are reluctant to bother somebody, and they feel that these volunteers are being bothered. In fact, volunteers love to be bothered. And secondly, if there's a cost issue around it, I think it is of concern to them. But I think with some education that could be overcome. In this town. This town's a little bit unique when you think about it. I think there's probably fairly good insurance coverage for even the non-elderly in this town.
If there's any elderly that don't understand insurance, I'm right up there with them. Yes, Councilor Roberts.
Madam Chair, I've got both some, I guess, some comments and some questions. But hope I can read my notes, put my glasses on here. On the fee, obviously, I would guess that Cape Elizabeth is going to have a higher collection rate than the 80%. More people are going to have insurance than a community like South Portland or Portland. South Portland does not bill people more than twice if they can't pay. And I think it's commonly known in the city by everybody that if they don't have insurance, it's not going to be sent to a collection agency and they're not going to have any bad credit ratings. I think it works very well there. And it's a resource that's available to the community. We should be tapping into it like anybody else. As far as the pay issue is concerned, Mike mentioned it just briefly a second ago, that the firefighters still consider themselves volunteers. And to pay somebody with a life-saving skill to go out and give them a stipend of $9 an hour or whatever is hardly being paid. The rescue can still consider themselves to be a volunteer effort in this town. You could not buy what they're providing for that kind of fee if you were going to pay them a salary. It just wouldn't work. I have a question, I guess, perhaps to Mike or one of the people in the audience, too. Currently, the call firefighters get paid when they go out on a fire response. If they're called in on a second tone to respond on a rescue, they get paid, is that correct?
That's correct.
First, So under the new scenario, they would get paid if they respond on the first call?
They get paid when they go on a call. All firemen do.
So they need to be members of the rescue to,
right,
to respond to a call. They just can't go as firefighters. They need to be called either as a member of the rescue or the call company needs to be called. They wouldn't be paid if they just showed up as a firefighter and they weren't a member of the rescue.
But there would be more incentive at this point for them to get on board and be part of the rescue as well, perhaps.
That would keep an incentive for them to become members of the rescue, which is okay. What we have desired.
But Dr. Higgins' comments about wellness was interesting, but Medicare and insurances will pay for the ambulance runs. I'm not going to sure that they would pay for in-house training. It's a good thought, but I don't believe the money's there to help us out on that. The final question I had, I guess, was on the call out on the paramedics. They would only get paid, they wouldn't get paid if they just responded, but they would get paid if they were called out after the fact.
Yeah, the way this is written is they would get paid $10 an hour if they simply responded to a call. If they're involved in the transport, they get paid $50 per call.
So in other words, if an EMT showed up, decided we needed a paramedic, and they came out at that point, they would get their $50, but there's that delay of them actually arriving between the time that the EMT went and decided we needed a higher level of skill, correct?
That generally doesn't happen. That, you know, once an EMT is called, you know, they're in communication. You know, they have radios, and I can answer. I would defer to the fire chief on that one. Yeah, I just don't see that happening. If paramedic gets called, they're going with the unit.
Okay. I'll defer to somebody else at this point, I guess, and see what else is said.
Am I wrong, Chief?
The way I visualize this working, excuse me, there's a number of... The plan, as we put it out, isn't the panacea to handle the whole thing. The plan is a starting point, is what it is. So there's some things that haven't been completely set to cement yet, and it'll take time, and we will work through those. But the way I would visualize it happening is that for certain types of calls, they'd be put out as a paramedic call. The dispatcher knew he had a cardiac call. He'd put out a paramedic call. And there would be certain asthmatics, and some of these types of calls would be put out that way. Other than that, it would happen as it happens now. When somebody gets on the scene and determines that they need a paramedic, they would call the dispatcher and the dispatcher would tone out for a paramedic. It would be kind of a two-phase response to what you're saying.
I'm not sure that I understand still. If the tone went out for a paramedic and they responded, what are they going to get paid?
What are they going to get paid?
They get $10 an hour, and if they're involved in the transport of the patient, they get $50 instead. And there's nothing in this proposal that says that it has to be a paramedic call either.
What do you mean?
If a paramedic responds to a call and they're involved in the transport of the patient, they get $50. There's nothing that says in this that it has to be a paramedic call.
What? I'm confused.
Chief, do you know in another community, or I can actually ask one of these wonderful paramedics that's already sitting here, if you break down your pay in a full-time job, what do you get paid for a call? I mean, it's $50. I don't know whether it's $20, $100, or $400.
Yeah, what it is in the way that Michael came up with the first $10 figure was that I had given him a number of figures from all of the surrounding areas to determine what the pay rate should be. What happened with the $10 rate is that the manager was looking at places like South Portland, all of the places that have paramedic coverage, but they're working an 8-hour shift or a 10-hour shift or whatever the case is. So they're paid by an hourly wage, and that's where the $10 came. So in the feeling of some of us that $10 an hour isn't going to make a hoot, okay? If we don't look at a substantial amount of money to pay them per call, then they're not going to turn out. And I don't see any guarantee in this room right now that even with a substantial amount of money that they're going to turn out.
but as what we're trying to do with this entire plan is go in a forward direction. This is the second of two plans. And as the manager said, it took over a year, and we brought the rescue and the town folks and EMS and everybody else into the plan, and they looked at everything, and they made a recommendation, and this is where we are. And I see real, I don't see good things happening if we start picking and choosing the parts of the plan that we want. It's a total package. And I'll be the first person to sit here and say, I don't believe this is the end. You know, we may be back here in 2 months saying, look, you know, we did this for the paramedic thing. We talked to everybody that was within distance of helping us, and it doesn't appear that they're going to do this. And so now what do we do? As somebody else stated here tonight, they told you all of the locations in the area that have round-the-clock service. And we're one of the few that doesn't. And I don't think we should go directly there. Definitely not go directly there. But I think that's something that we're looking at in the future. But we've got to see if we can entice some people to come into this in the meantime. And a couple other points while I'm up here. I don't think anybody's any closer to the medical center of the Mercy than Portland or South Portland. And they provide a paramedic service. I think the public has come to believe that they need a paramedic service. One of the problems that we're faced with, and we did a study, is that we looked at last year, and I had Roz Flaherty look at the figures, and said that we had the possibility of 50 paramedic calls. I think we had South Portland out here every 20-odd times last year. I think we've had South Portland out here already this year close to 40 times. Okay? If this scenario or this plan that we're giving you fails, South Portland is standing by us and helping us. But what are they going to do when we're not going to move forward on the issues? I don't know. You know, it could be the thing that forces us over the edge and kicks us from taking this a step at a time to go into a paramedic service. You know, I don't know the answer to that. But I know that everybody in the group has got a different opinion on different parts of the plan. But we've been a long time coming to this point. And I say, we need to move forward with this plan. I mean, it's time to do something. Councilor Roberts knows. He hears the talk in South Portland City Hall. Chief True calls me all the time. The manager and I have met with the South Portland city manager, and they're willing to help us out. But the end's drawing near. I mean, they have their own internal budgetary manpower problems. And we, the administrators, are well aware of what those problems are. And we need to get off the stick, and we need to move forward. And again, I say, this isn't the end results. I mean, it's going to move forward from here. But we need to do something, folks. I mean, this was brought forth by a counselor initially because she heard of rumblings that we needed some help. And it was a council goal, I believe. And we did the plan, and we met in workshops. This plan that we came out with a professional facilitator, the end results of that plan was no different and what the rescue members had done 2 years prior to that under Captain Groton and come out with the same types of recommendations. You need to do some of these things, folks. And so we did it again. And I plead with you. You know, I feel like I'm in a bad position up here because I got this group on this side, that group on that side, and I am not going to win, okay? But I need to tell you, as your hired gun, what the facts of life are and what we need to do. And I will do that. I will be straightforward and honest with you and lay it on the line with you. And I don't always like the position that I have to take because of the position it puts me in. But I'm going to give you the truth.
And in support of your comments, I think that we all agree that there is a change coming to us. It is a difficult to put a town into a change, and it's maybe difficult for you to recommend it. I don't think there's anyone up here that denies the fact that we need to do something about paramedics. We're just not too sure exactly how or what we're going to do and how much it's going to cost. But we absolutely know that we're going to move forward on the paramedic issue for sure. And I know that these are all intertwined, and maybe we can't do one without the other, but we hear you, and we appreciate your efforts.
I would make one other comment, too, if I could. I have with me the Journal of Maine EMS, latest edition. And I guess I would read something for clarification purposes for a question that was asked.
Put your speaker up so that the TV audience could hear. Just raise it up a little. Thank you.
I don't want to touch it like Jimmy, it'll fall off. Does the updated EMTI replace the need for a higher level ALS? And the answer is absolutely not. The update program is not intended to add a new license level, nor is it intended to replace the EMTC or the EMTP level. In fact, the updated EMTI protocols require immediate, intermediate EMTs to call for ALS backup.
Excuse me, Chief. As you read these things, rather than using the acronyms, could you translate ALS to advanced life support?
I'm sorry.
You just did.
I'll just start over.
Yeah.
To replace the EMTC cardiac tech, okay, or EMTP paramedic level. In fact, the updated EMTI intermediate protocols require an intermediate EMT to call for advanced life support backup, if available. In every instance where medication or other ALS advanced life support protocols or procedures are administered. So what that means is that, yes, our EMTIs, which we have 10 to 12 now, who are very good, under this are still required to call South Portland and say, send us a paramedic. So the numbers that are escalating with South Portland at this point are going to continue to go up. Unfortunately, I personally believe, okay, that we shouldn't have to do that. And I think there are a lot of people in the audience that agree too. But we're bound by protocols, and we have to follow state protocols. I mean, there's a lot of times when we have to call for the next up person, whether we think we have to or not. It states that you shall. It's not that you will.
Can I make a comment?
Are there any
on that?
Questions? Yes, to the chief while he's still up there.
I'd like to indicate that this is a pilot program that started 10 days ago. And of course they want, and somebody, I think maybe Mark mentioned that for QI purposes, to have paramedics check and make sure that the intermediates are doing the right thing.
I agree.
And, you know, that doesn't mean that that process will continue forever. If it's a successful pilot program, then in the future, the intermediates may be able to push the drugs with just medical control as opposed to having to call a paramedic. And I think that the intermediates probably feel more comfortable having a paramedic, particularly the ones that we have in South Portland, coming and saying, yeah, you did the right thing, or, hey, here's what I would do. And it's a pilot program at this point. If successful, that may not occur in the future.
I agree 100%.
Okay, are there any further questions? You can ask the chief anytime, but is there anybody while he's right here right now? Okay, thank you. Right now, we'll move to Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, every time I think I've got my arms around this issue, it escapes me. It's elusive. But I agree with what our chief has said about, you know, the progress that we've made over the last 2 years, and how do you start carving up something, and are you going to leave something out if you don't take it as a whole, and it's not a perfect entity. And one thing that comes to mind to me as I hear these comments is, because of the nature, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I am not an expert in this area, but it seems to me by the nature of the number of hours and different levels of experience you have to gain to be a paramedic, that almost dictates that that individual, because of that, is going to be a more mature individual. And by and large, that generally means in our society that they take on other roles as family members and parents, et cetera. And usually in today's society, it's a two-working family with children, and you have to manage that workload. And it gets harder and harder, I think I hear paramedics say, to make that decision to get up and leave those other responsibilities of work and family for not a for a very nominal fee. And in my view, $50 for a call is nominal, but it's certainly better than $10 a call. And I'm hoping that I've heard you folks correctly, but that's my perception of the nature of the paramedic almost dictates that you're going to have more responsibilities that you have to juggle. And where 7 years ago you might have said, I don't care, I'll go do it, now you've got the responsibilities of what do you do for child care, and what do you do about making choices and prioritizing your time, and what's it worth to you to make those choices. And I think we have to compensate people, not totally, because but to compensate them in some way to incent them to get up and make this kind of contribution, because all of us prioritize. And Jimmy, we don't get paid quite as much as you do per day, but you know, as volunteers, we do get up and, you know, as counselors, we do our job, you know, and we do it because we want to make a contribution. I mean, you should be a counselor, but the reality is that, you know, we all want to make a contribution when we serve in any of these kinds of capacities, and whether we get paid 25 cents a day, 50 cents a day, $3 a day, or $8 or $9 an hour, it really doesn't usually compensate us for the skills that we bring to the table. And we do it because we have something that moves us on, spurs us on to make those kinds of contributions. And whether there isn't a volunteer fire, and my father's been a volunteer fire department firefighter for 40 years, and there's nothing, I can tell you, there's not a volunteer firefighter in this state that gets up and does it for the money. And there's not a rescue person, by and large, that does that either. It's not the pay that motivates them, but it does help defer some of the cost, because firefighters have to have more training all the time, so do rescue people. And our police department, you know, we can't have volunteer police department people. You know, we have to pay them because of the nature of that public safety job. But, you know, they don't do it for the money necessarily all the time either. There's something greater that spurs them on as well. So my basic feeling is, whether it's a private enterprise or if it's a public safety kind of job, anyone that carries a beeper and has that kind of responsibility to respond, no, we don't pay them what the going rate for their time is, but I think there's at some level, based on what they bring to the table and what we get back, there needs to be compensation, and it's usually by a minimum number of hours. And my feeling is that, you know, with this $50 an hour for a paramedic that gets in the transport and transports someone to the hospital, that, you know, that's a start. And I think that, you know, we're not paying them any more than we are asking anyone to carry a beeper for 3 or 4 hours, and we compensate them. And companies do it all the time in private enterprise, and we do it in public safety kinds of jobs. So I think we need to look at it in the same light. And because you're on call, you know, whether you're paid or not, you know, I still think you can call yourself respectfully a volunteer for what you bring to the table and bring to the society and community in which you live. And one thing I want to make a comment about, and that is that I want to make it very clear to the people who are listening and that haven't had a chance to read the documents and be in the workshops, that this fee for service is for those people who can afford to pay, that have insurance. If you don't have insurance, a bill collector isn't going to knock on your door and say, you owe us X amount of dollars. That's not going to happen in Cape Elizabeth. It doesn't happen in South Portland. It's not going to happen here. So people who need this service still can call. And there's no shame in that. You know, all we're trying to do is provide a higher level of service, because the sophistication of that's required today to handle these kinds of calls and the training dictate to us that we're in this situation today. So, you know, call. You know, don't not call. And, you know, I would just like to see us be able to phase in the fees. And I think we're doing that, because we're at a lower level of the fees. And as we go, we've talked about we may have to increase them. But, you know, I think that we need to move forward. My personal feeling is that we need to I think if we call out a paramedic, we need to pay them $50, whether they transport or not. But you know, if they're called, you know, I think that's something we need to look at. Because I think there are people in this room that have come here because we've said we recognize the deficiency in our system, we want to do something, and there's interest. So we need to respond to that interest. Because one paramedic in Cape Elizabeth isn't going to get it in the next year or the next 5 years. And we need to encourage and incent people by paying for their training so they can get higher level training to go from a basic to an intermediate. And I don't have all the appropriate acronyms, but we need to help them with their education just like we do firefighters. And that's in this plan. We talk about that. We talk about increasing the amount of money that we currently budget. So, and in this plan, there's $45,000 that's been denoted on a line item as uncollectible. So already out of the gate, we're already addressing that issue. So I say let's move on. Let's put everybody on notice. We're going to be watching closely, like practical difficulty. You know, come back to us. Let's tweak it. Let's go. I don't know. I mean, it's not a perfect system. I don't know anything that is. Thank you.
I was just trying to think of one. A perfect system.
If you let me know.
And Councilor Swift-Cata, please.
Councilor Watson is very eloquent, and I commend her eloquence. I have thought long and hard about this issue. I have not heard from anyone who's spoken today significant or strong objections. Of course, there are differences on aspects of the details of the program, but I want to thank everybody. I join in thanking everybody who's spoken tonight, because I know you've put a lot of thought into this, and we on the council really appreciate what you've said, because it's helped shape my opinion, and I'm sure it's helped shape the opinions of the other people on the council. I also want to thank everybody on the rescue and the various public service departments in town who participate in helping people in this town, helping the citizens of this town. I've never had occasion to use the rescue service or the fire department. I hope never to have to use those services, but I'm really glad that you're there, and I appreciate the spirit of volunteerism that has moved you. It makes Cape Elizabeth a great place to live, and you know, it sounds corny, but thank you. It's really great that you do this. That said, I think the status quo is not an option from what everybody has said. I do think we need to move forward. People of goodwill and good intentions can disagree about exactly how we should move forward, the details of how to get there, but I think the basic plan seems to be supported from everything I've heard. I've heard no objections from anyone outside of this meeting either. And so I think we should move forward, and I think I'll be supporting the plan unless I hear anything differently in the next few minutes.
Mm-hmm. Councilor McGinty.
A couple of comments. First of all, I don't think that the basic four issues are necessarily linked to each other. That is the paying the rescue, paramedic service, fees for service, and I guess the paramedic service kind of goes along with our relationship with South Portland. Mm-hmm. I guess if you want to consider those two separate items, they are certainly linked. But Anne made the point I was going to make, it that not a single citizen that is not involved some way or another with this has spoken tonight, pro or con. Everybody who's spoken has some interest, some stake in the situation. I brought our survey from last year, and I just might add that the rescue service got the highest score for excellent service, higher than the police department, sorry, Neil, the fire department, snow removal, everybody but
the
transfer station. The transfer station. Go figure, you got to lug your bags up there, and they get, you know, the guy sits in the booth and they get the best. But I think it's important to know that that's the way the citizens feel about the rescue. I mean, they think it's the best service other than the transfer station in the town, and that nobody's come here and said one way or another. I think they like the service they get. They know they're getting good service, and it should be improved. I would like to see us separate out the issues. I think that we need to deal with the paramedic issue forthwith, that we should ask the rescue to bring us back an exact plan, what they're going to do. By the way, I don't think $50 is enough. I said that previously. I said that at the workshop. I've mentioned it to at least one person in the room here, that I don't think that's enough. And I'd be willing to pay even more to get the paramedics to get out of bed at 3 o'clock in the morning. But I think what we need to do is ask for a specific plan from the rescue that says these 3, 4, 5, 6 paramedics will do it if we do this. They don't want, maybe won't want to do night duty. If Scott only has one day a week he can do it, that's fine. You know, if we can use him on one day, we'll use him on one day. Whether they need to be paid for standby, you know, $1 an hour, $2 an hour, whatever it is. I know that private industry does that. They pay their people to be on standby over the weekends. I don't know what the direct answer is, but I think that we need an answer, and we need it as soon as possible. So I wouldn't recommend deferring that process at all. I think we should have, by next meeting, a specific plan that we can say, this is what we got, this is what we can tell South Portland we got, and this is what it's going to cost. If we have a budget, we know it's going to cost. The problems I have with the other areas, and I said, well, I think I will be moving, voting tonight to move that process forward. As far as the pay for the rescue, and of course I would benefit financially from that, so I obviously have a personal stake, but I'm one of those people who doesn't, I don't care if I get paid or not. If I end up donating, like I do my council check to Fields for Kids or something, I'll go somewhere. There may be other options than just an hourly pay. Some places use a stipend. I think Westbrook maybe used to use a stipend plan where you have to go to so many calls before you get a basic amount of money. Then if you go to a certain amount more calls, you get another level of money. I think just paying per call, you know, $8.50, $9.50 a call, isn't going to motivate too many more people to do the job. But, and also, we average now five people a call on a rescue call. If it does work as an incentive, what if we start getting 10 or 12 people on a call? Is that going to wreak havoc on our budget? I mean, do we just unlimit if all 30 people show up on a call? We're going to pay everybody? And so I think we have to have those kinds of issues sorted out before we enact an actual pay plan. And I think we can do it again, but that's something that's not as urgent as the paramedic plan. I'm willing to get some more information on that. The fee for service, as Mike alluded to, I sent him an email a week or so ago, and everybody keeps saying 80% recovery, but some information I have is that it may be 80% of the big picture. I mean, 80% of the actual calls. If there's 500 calls, we get 80% recovery, but it may not be 100% of the cost of that call, if you understand what I'm saying. They may only pay a portion of that what that call costs. And so, you know, I asked for more information, and I'd like to, again, see more information for voting for fee for service. And as we need to implement it, I agree with Penny or Ann Sump, or maybe it was Ruth, I can't remember now, who said, you know, phasing it in. And certainly we need to have a lot of education, because for people who have been getting a free service for so many years, and they start hearing we're going to start charging people, I think there needs to be a long education process. So that's something I don't think we should just outright implement tonight, that we need to get all the information, be prepared with our educational program before we implement something like that. So that's where I stand. That's what I'd like to see the council do tonight, is to ask for a specific plan for the paramedics, what's it going to cost, look for some options for paying the rescue members and how that would work, numbers of people show up, higher level license shows up, you know, that they take preference over a lower level. I mean, there's a lot of questions in my mind. And the fee for service. And I'd also like to talk about South Portland a lot. I have a report here from Task Force on Intergovernmental Structure prepared for the governor. It's actually a 1997 report, but one of their core concepts is municipal government should aggressively seek opportunities to avail themselves of joint services. And so after we determine what our paramedic system looks like, that's when I think we need to go to South Portland and say, you know, how can we balance this out in some way that that if we have to pay per call or enter into just a large contract of some sort or share a paramedic, we pay half their salary, they pay half the salary. I mean, there's all kinds of options available. But I'd like to see us first figure out what our paramedic program is before we even approach that, so we have something to tell them, here's what we're doing. As Kevin says, they keep asking, what are you doing, what are you doing? We need to say, here's what we've done.
Okay, Michael wants to respond.
Yeah, just very briefly, there were some comments made that some of our rates were lower than other places. The reason for that is because we anchored them based on the Medicare eligible rates, so that we wouldn't get into that position of having the amounts we were billed being knocked down to a lower amount, so that in essence Medicare was paying a different rate than the insurance companies. We set all the rates based on Medicare rates, so that way we feel comfortable that, you know, if in fact it's 80%, there's not a further diminution of that 80% rate. As to, you know, the comment of, you know, we ought to go back to the rescue and have them set up a pay plan, you know, I thought back in December that, you know, we decided to go a route that you would ask the manager to work with folks to come up with an implementation plan. And, you know, we've done that. We've had the numbers, the council, since March 1st. And, you know, I think there'll be new proposals or new ways to pay, you know, continuously. And, you know, generally, you know, we want an incentive to responding to calls. We don't want people to get discouraged. Oh, I don't think I'm going to make it. You know, I'm not going to make that level of the 40%. So, you know, there's no sense in me going anymore. You know, not that, you know, there are some people who are impacted like that. So I would like to have an incentive for going each and every time, rather than someone get discouraged, I'm not going to make it, so I'm not going to get paid, so I'm not going to bother for the rest of the month. So I think this is a good system we have. I think it's been given a lot of thought. It's had a lot of input. And actual, you know, what the cost is going to be of the paramedics, quite frankly, you know, I could come back to you next month. We don't know exactly, because we don't know how many paramedic calls there are going to be, and we also don't know how many are going to actually be responding, nor do we with any of this. It's all estimates that do need to be looked at after we have more experience. So, you know, we can come back with more numbers, but they're still going to be very pliable numbers, because, you know, and you don't know when the rescue is going out until the bell goes off, and you don't know who's responding until you've got back to the hospital, in essence.
I just think that, I mean, we're entering into a plan that we have no idea what it's going to cost. And, you know, I mean, I think those issues have to be addressed if 10 people show up. You know, only one or two or three people, most, can work on a patient at any given time. And so, you know, if people can go thinking, gee, I'll only be there for 15 minutes because I won't go on the ambulance, you know, I'll just go back home and get paid for the call. You know, I don't suggest that the rescue members would exploit that, but it's always there's a potential for that. You have 10 people show up on a call.
I think there's definitely that potential, Councilor McGinty, and I think, you know, you hire administrators and with the chief, myself, and others who look at those issues, and, you know, I think if you even look tonight's agenda, when we hear new information, we adopt new views. And, you know, we're not going to be cast in concrete simply because of, you know, this plan. If we find there's elements of this that aren't working, we're not going to wait a year to come back to the council. We're going to come back just as soon as we find out that a certain aspect isn't working.
Don't you think it would be better to have a plan in place that tells us that if an intermediate shows up on a call after basics are already there, that the intermediate would take over the call, and then one of the basics would be bumped off the call? And all those, I think those are issues that need to be addressed.
I think those are protocols that need to be reviewed within the fire department, within the rescue, and not at the council level.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. That's why I said that we should have a plan come back from the rescue people to say, this is how it's going to work.
No, I don't think that plan should come back to the council. I think those are protocols that ought to occur at the department and company level.
Well, I can look at that.
Stuck. I don't know where to go.
Madam Chair, just one additional question or comment.
Councilor Roberts.
When South Portland responds on a rescue call now with their paramedics, they are billing Cape Elizabeth residents. Has the town received any complaints about being billed that you're aware of?
We've had some We've had some complaints from the citizens when they've been billed, and the biggest thing was that they'd never been billed before, and they wanted to know what the story was. And, you know, at least in one particular instance, we feel that it was self-fall, and then it became a non-issue.
Okay, thank you.
You mean when you explained to them that they were on board because it was a paramedic and...
In some cases, it was a situation where we had South Fulton come in and handle a call for us, and so then South Fulton billed for the call, and they'd never been billed. They may have been in the ambulance before and never been billed, and they wanted to know what it was. And I explained to them that when South Fulton comes out, South Fulton has a billing policy. We don't. Kind of works in reverse. When we go to South Fulton and we lug one of South Fulton's patients, they love it because they get a free call at this time. But it has not been an issue.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I think that Councilor McGinty raises some very good questions, and I think that they merit further evaluation by the appropriate parties, and the key in that is the appropriate parties. And you know, I think we can tread, you know, real closely on this one of micromanaging it. And you know, I don't like to use that word very often, because I think it's very overused. But no more than I would like to tell Neil Williams what to do with his, you know, police department. I don't want to tell Chief McGuldick what to do with fire, or our captain of the rescue, Evelyn Cox, what to do, how to set the protocols. I mean, I think that we have very good people that, I mean, if they haven't thought of these questions, I guarantee you they've written them down tonight. And they're going to find the answers because someone's going to be asking them. And they're going to find a way. But I really don't think that for me, without the expertise, I mean, I don't even understand all the acronyms, so, you know, for me to evaluate what's appropriate or not, because I don't deal with these people that are in this room every day and understand what their needs are and what will incent them and what won't. But, you know, I surely expect that Chief McGuldrick and Evelyn Cox know, or if they don't know, they're going to find out. So, I mean, my basic feeling is that, you know, we can beat this, or we can accept it as a flaw, somewhat flawed, but boy, 2 years worth of work, and move forward on it and adjust it as we go. And when I say we, I'm not talking about the council. I'm talking about the powers that be that work in that arena every day. And then, you know, when there's something we need to know about, getting back to us. Or we'll get back to them. I mean, if we hear from a lot of our constituents that they're not happy, believe me, you know, you'll be hearing from us. So, you know, so, I mean, we've got a fail-safe system here almost. And I just would like to see us move it forward. And I don't know, I know that Councillor Fritz and Councillor Barry probably have other input, but I would like to, at some point in the not-too-distant future, move the question.
We don't have a question yet.
I know.
Councillor Fritz.
I have two more questions. How much are we paying in training, the cost of training now? Are we paying now? Are we paying everything?
We do some reimbursements. Could you explain that, Chief?
At the present time, after a person completes their EMT, they pay the upfront cost on their EMT schooling, and $325, I believe, plus $40 for a book. After they complete it, we reimburse them for that. In some of the intermediate training, people that have been on the squad and have provided service already and shown that they're going to be with us, we've paid some upfront costs. And that's changed from what it used to be. It all used to be a 50% after the fact. And we have adjusted to some of the training issues from that. The intent would be to pay the rescue personnel for their training time as well. And in talking with the Roz Flaherty, who's in charge of training for the rescue, she feels that that would help a lot They don't get as many people to training as she'd like, and she feels that that would help a lot.
This is for their time at the in-house provided training?
That's correct.
Not for their...
And it's the same way with the fire. If they take an EMT course, they're not going to get an hourly wage for it. But it would be for in-house training.
Do you have another question?
I guess another question for Dr. Higgins. I mean, I have to take the medical advice and opinion very highly here. And I'm just wondering how comfortable you are as a resident of the town, the level of our service now, and whether it does need upgrading. Your comfort level for your own family. If we increased the training level to the more intermediate level,
Well, having sutured all of my children on my kitchen table, suffered through listening to my youngest go through croup several times, and knowing why people rush to the hospital with kids with croup, all of our children, tens and tens of years, have never gone to the emergency department, and we've never called a rescue. So I'm going to have to virtual this one. First off, I think the level of care provided by the rescue has day in and day out met the needs of the people in our town. And I think that they've used the South Portland Intercept as their backup, and South Portland has been extremely gracious with that. Now, that has not been without its bumps, and there have been, I'm sad to report, there have been fairly highly publicized incidents where the Cape Rescue, I think, has received fairly undeserved public criticism in the arena of the EMT world. And I think that has been very hurtful and harmful to them and cast a shadow of what they do every day. And I think that's been extremely hard for them. So that's my back. And the other thing I think I have to remember, it might not be 4 to 5 minutes to Maine Med, but I worked at Stevens Hospital yesterday. Is today Monday? Yeah, yesterday. And I was getting calls from people that were 45 minutes from the hospital. We're quite blessed in being very close to the place where you can definitive care. But I am a believer that training and skill and assessment and judgment and professionalism is important in how we make these safety issues and risk stratify. So I think I would be totally, I would not feel that I'm saying the right thing to say that if we went to a higher level of service, no matter what that looked at. And I must say this, I have not read your report. And so I think I was alluding to 24 hours as one end of the model. So I'm not suggesting that I thought that was in there. I can't believe that that would increase our ability to do the right thing for our people, and train the intermediates, and train the basics. So I think that probably it would be an enhancement that would be of value. But it's not going to be of value for 450 people out of the 500. And if it's my person that's the 50, one of the 50, I guess it would be extremely valuable to me. And what's that price to us as a community? I don't know. I'm in this business, so I'm a stakeholder. I'm a biased person. So that's a roundabout way of getting a non-answer to you. Sorry.
Skillfully done.
No, I thought you, Council McGinty?
On fees for service, I think that the recommendation is that as long as it will not destroy the morale of the rescue people, that fees for service, which would be covered by insurance, would not impose any financial hardship on the citizens who are calling the rescue. And as long as that would be covered, by, as Amanda said, by the Medicare level, which covers me too, that would be appropriate to defray some of the costs. And as far as pay for rescue personnel, I'd leave that to the the chief to work out with the rescue personnel. As far as paramedics, I would support going forward with...
As far as what, Henry? I can hear you.
Paramedics. Oh, that's the final issue. You mentioned fees for service, pay for rescue personnel, and paramedics. And the paramedics being the final issue. And South Portland Mutual Aid, as Council McGinney says, is sort of locked into the paramedic issue. And I think we should move forward with that. Those are my thoughts.
Council McGinty.
Is there any way we could vote on those three issues separately?
It's the will of the council. You can certainly vote on them. Yeah, there isn't. You didn't make a motion when you did it the first time, so.
Say that again. I didn't make it.
You had the motions. There's no motions at all on the table now. So if you want to vote on anything separately, the council will have to vote on it.
I move that the rescue company,
clarification. would you perhaps want to move the question as to whether the council wants to address them separately first?
Yes.
Separately or together?
Oh, okay.
Oh, I thought you were going right.
I thought you said there's
no motion on the table, and if you'd like to address them separately, you'd have to make that motion, and the council will vote on whether they want to.
Okay, I move that we address them separately. The three issues: fees, pay, and paramedic cover.
Second.
Okay. Now it's been moved and seconded that we address those three issues separately. With any comments and discussion? Is there any comments and discussion about the motion?
I would only say the reason I do that, I really think it's not good public policy to, you know, if we're in budget hearings, we'd be going over this with a fine-tooth comb to determine exactly what this is going to cost. And we're essentially writing a blank check for some of this. I just don't think that's good public policy to say, yeah, do a plan, we don't care what it costs. That's what we're saying. We're saying, hey, chief, make a plan, and whatever it costs, it costs. And I think that we need to know what it costs. So that's why I'd like to separate them out.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I would prefer to vote for them all three together because I see this as an integrated plan that sort of all meshes together. So that's my little contribution to discussion.
I have to concur.
So in defense of Councilor McGinty's comments, it is, I mean, I'm not saying whether I agree, it is unusual for us to say, first of all, nobody for once has said, how can we do this? This isn't even the budget process. That's usually the question that comes to me when we do this. So we are, in a sense, voting for something that we do not know the cost of the community.
You can never predict the future perfectly, but I would argue that this integrated plan is a revenue neutral proposal as an integrated plan. You know, the revenues match the expenses, and I understand that things can come up, and you don't know if the revenues will be what we project or if the expenses will be what we project. But that's for just that reason, for the budget reason, I prefer to vote on all of it together because I see it as an integrated plan which has no net effect on the town and on the taxpayers as an integrated plan.
Councilor Fritz.
I would like to see it separated because I don't think we have enough information on the paramedic issue yet. When I heard concerns about the rescue, I thought it was an issue of not having enough personnel during the daytime, not the level of the personnel so much. And so as I've been thinking about this, I've been thinking that we need to have more emphasis on training at a higher level and compensating for that training and encouraging more people to take it and join the rescue. I don't know if there's some impression it may be a little more closed than it really is. And so my emphasis is more on that rather than this specific plan. I'm interested in exploring a little bit more about the paramedics and whether we may need that higher level. But I guess I'd like to go with the training and recruitment and see how whether we can improve it on that level before we go to a huge budget item and a whole new program and personnel, employees, all that sort of thing. And the issue of the paying the rescue, part of me says that we ought to pay about the same as we do the fire department when they go on calls. But it seems to be such a divided issue among the rescue that among the rescue themselves that I'm not sure we're ready to make that decision yet.
On the amount, you mean?
On whether to pay. So I would like to divide the issue and do more exploring of the paramedic issue.
Well, I guess I'm trying to figure out where I've been coming from on this. I've done a lot of talking in the last 4 or 5 days with many people on where I am on the whole issue. And I have to say that 3 hours ago, I was certainly with Councillor McGinty in separating the issues out to deal with them. But I have to say that I have not been persuaded by the public comments tonight that anybody wants anything different than what's in this plan. I mean, nobody has come, if we're here to get public hearing, nobody has come to say to us, boy, I think this is a bad idea, and I don't think you should do this, and we're not really ready for paramedics, and nobody has said anything negative about this plan anywhere. So, as an elected person, where I was when I came here tonight, not prepared to vote yes on everything, although I agreed with each of the four items, I was not prepared to vote for it tonight as a group. But I have not been persuaded, although I think Councillor McGinty has made some very good points, and he's the only one that knows anything about this, because surely I don't know anything about the intricacies of working in a rescue department and how to schedule and how to do these things. I do take into the fact that the plan has been here for a long time. I am upset about the fact that I really, even though there is a pro forma in the back of our document, it is at best a pro forma. It's, you know, as to whether it can work financially. So I guess you've covered yourselves on that. So I guess where I am, as I say, where I was 3 hours ago, was with understanding what John's feeling is when he puts forward now that we should take it separately. But I can see that the council is not going to support that. So I guess we're going to call the question on Councillor McGinty's motion now. All those in favor of separating the issues to take them one at a time, all those in favor? Three. Opposed? See, I know what Barry was going to do. I've given John McGinty the opportunity.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Then I would like to make another motion.
Okay.
And that motion would be that the council adopt the implementation strategy presented to us effective October 1st, 2000, with the amendment on this top sheet that we're looking at, that the paramedics receive $50 per transport to the hospital.
Second.
Any further discussion? Councilor McGinty.
Of course. What happens if the $50 doesn't work? What happens then?
Is it
a dead issue?
What's a dead issue? I mean, that they're not going to be paid?
No, he's okay. Saying it's not enough.
It's not enough.
Or to whatever.
Well, I would hope that they'd increase it.
Who's got the authority now? And where are you giving the authority to increase that?
I would hope it would go
if
back.
If the council sets this and it doesn't work, you know, as I mentioned 5 minutes ago, 10 minutes ago, we'll come back to the council at any time with updates and give you the opportunity whether or not you wish to amend it. What I mean is these larger issues, not the individual protocols of how this implements. But if there's something that we specifically suggested you vote on that we thought was at your level, and you have voted on it, and we want to do something that contradicts that, it's got to come back to the council, and it will come back as soon as we know it's a problem.
Madam Chair, oh, I'm sorry.
Yes,
I'm going to support the motion only because I think we need to move forward on the paramedic issue. I think that's critical that we do that. So I'm going to support this. I do think, and you know, everybody knows I'm a fiscal conservative around here, that it's bad public policy to implement a program you don't know how much it's going to cost. And but as I said, I think it's imperative that we move the paramedic situation forward, and I guess we'll go from there.
Madam Chair.
Council Watson.
I have a question, and that is, and I don't know why I haven't raised it before, but why October? I've missed something.
Time to implement it, to find out how it's going to work.
Earlier it was said that there needs to be a lot of education. That's first of all, there needs to be a lot of education. On our end, we need to be setting up all the forms that make sure that the pay things get right. We need to be setting up all of the billing systems so that those are right. And we also need to
publicize it.
To publicize it, get the word out. That's why it's October 1. You know, because it's really, it's, you know, that's only 2 months. And with the courier, with its lesser schedule, it doesn't give that much opportunity. But it's mainly internal stuff that get the protocols in place as well as the public education. The protocols will take time.
Councilor McGinty.
That just raised another question in my mind. It came up earlier about a billing company to do this. And there was some question about whether I think they got 9%, but there might be other companies that do it for less. Is this something that we will explore to find out what the best, our best shot is?
I think they have already done that.
We have been exploring. We have a better deal than the one that's in your packet.
Okay.
And it won't come back to the council, but we will do the best deal we can with a service provider that's reputable.
All right, and one last comment is that as we prepare to vote on this, is that I don't know exactly where it comes from, but I really would like to move forward on the paramedic thing. I can understand we need to pay for our rescue members, but I sure have trouble for fees for service, and I just don't see any way around it. And we got in our document that every other single town everywhere in the world is charging fees for service. So, I mean, who are we to not try and do it? But it sure does make me uncomfortable, and it sure does change the soul of our rescue program and the fear that it will be difficult to maintain. But I hope it will. So now we're going to call the question.
Madam Chair, if I could just add, I think the soul of our rescue service is the people who participate in it. And I don't think their hearts and their service are going to change whether there are fees or not. So I disagree. I think the soul is the people, and I think the people are great, and that's what's going to make the rescue program great, what has made it great and was going to continue to make it great for Cape Elizabeth.
Okay, we ready to move the question? This question, what is the question? Is it just the full packet? What is it?
Except it with the amendment for the permit.
Accept it with the amendment on the front page. All those in favor? Any opposed? The motion carries. Thank you very much. I'd like to have a 5.5-minute recess, please. Request from the town manager to provide funding for local costs related to OpSale 2000. Council, Mr. Manager.
Yes, thank you. We discussed this last month. The $10,000 includes $4,000 for portable toilets. And the balance is for overtime for the police department, for the call company pay for the fire department that will be present, for things such as emergency no parking signs, you know, all those stakes and all those signs, and they actually add up to funds. And we also plan to supplement our rescue service with a private rescue service that will be in the fort that day, along with our rescue, at a cost of approximately, where's the fire chief when I need him? I think it was $500.
Are there any paramedics on this?
I don't know. I am pleased to report that the net cost will be less than $10,000, because OpSale has now presented us a check for $1,000 to help defray some of our costs. We appreciate their partnership in this. And also Maine Radio, Rick Barker, who has worked with us on a number of projects, has agreed to donate all our needed radios, which is a cost that we were thinking we might have. But the $10,000 should be more than sufficient. My thought is it'll actually be a little less than that. But I want to be in a position to make sure we have enough money to carry this out. Planning's coming along fine. I can say this because this is only broadcast in Cape Elizabeth, and we've let the Courier know it's going to be their next paper. We are going to have a shuttle service working with community services from the school grounds to the fort, so even if the fort gets filled up, there still will be an option for Cape Elizabeth residents to take that shuttle. That will be for Cape Elizabeth residents only. There'll be school buses, there'll be two to three in some parts of the day, two at others, that folks that in Cape Elizabeth who live at this end of town who don't want to get down there, get caught in traffic, can take those shuttle buses. So.
I sort of imagine, I don't know if the chief can handle, I sort of imagine on the little two-lane road called Shore Road, that come 10:30 in the morning, it is going to be bumper-to-bumper stop traffic. And if you can only park 1,000 cars in the fort, where do you say, hey, sir, we're filled up, you have to go where? And how are you going to move that line if, I mean, what are you going to do with that traffic? I want to know what we're going to do with all those cars, because they're going to be stacked up bumper-to-bumper. And of course, send them through all the neighborhoods, I guess, but can park like, what, 1,900 cars?
I'd have to ask Bob how many cars, 1,000 cars.
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Excuse me?
Can you introduce yourself, please?
Neil Williams, new chief of police. On Shore Road, it is going to be very, very congested, but what we're going to try to do is alleviate traffic going to South Portland, and when they come out of the fort, everybody's going to come this way. And we'll have an officer up at the center of town because we all know that that can get congested up there on 77 to direct traffic in and out of Shore Road.
So when the cars are lined up and they can't get into the fort, you're just going to direct them all the way out to pick up this shuttle? Or how do you get them off the road?
Yes, we're going to just move them right out this way. Oh. That's correct. Yeah, we've got enough officers out.
We'll be turning some people away saying, listen, we're full.
We're not directing everyone to the shuttle. We're only doing that through publicity locally. Because otherwise, it could override our capacity to handle it, and we'll have people down there with the inability to return.
So that's Cape residents.
Cape
only
residents only.
Or the shuttle.
And it's only being publicized within Cape Elizabeth.
However, we feel that we have to alleviate some of the traffic to South Portland because they're going to be in trouble down there on Spring Point. Also.
Broadway is going to be the same way. Yeah.
Instead of sending them back into gridlock, we feel that if we send them back out this way. And let them at least filter out through 77. That way, if they want to get back to Portland.
They'll be in the cars. They won't see anything. It will have happened, probably.
If you ask me what's going to happen beach to beach, and we can tell you. What's going to happen at OpSale is a new event. We are planning for the unexpected.
Okay. Madam Chair.
Yes.
I know the town manager's thoughts on this, but he and I don't agree, so I'm going to bring it up anyway. The Spring Point Museum is raising money by allowing a certain number of people into the museum to the lighthouse to view the OpSale parade. And I thought it would be an interesting way to raffle off or sell off some high-priced tickets for people to get up into the tower and pull a headlight. And I'm talking big money, $500 to $1,000 to get four or five people up there to sit down and watch it. And I don't know how others feel about it, but it's some good money to fund this thing. And
I think it's a couple of weeks away. It makes it a little hard to market it.
We generally, other than major public events, we generally don't have the tower open because of handicapped ADA accessibility issues. plus, we looked at it, and every time we open that tower up and have people up there, it becomes a major issue. Why can't I get up there? And I know the last time we had it open for volunteers, I ended up being down there for 5 or 6 hours, and I can't tell you the number of people I let up who had nothing to do because they begged and they had come all the way here and whatever. And it's just once people begin to see people up there, it's bad public relations for the others.
Yeah.
I guess I don't look at it as a fundraising event. I've made up my mind that I've already tried the parking issue and all the rest of it. We're not going to make money on it. We're just going to
I was going to try to break even.
Yeah. Is OpSale going to pay, well, they're just paying $1,000, but aren't they making some money out of this situation?
They don't have any money. They don't have any money.
Madam Chair.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
I commend Councilor Roberts' creativity. I think there may be logistical problems with it, but I appreciate his efforts to try and get the town some of the money back that we're going to spend on this. I have a question. Is the museum shop, which is a big money maker for us anyways, going to be open sort of early and late with extra staff, hopefully, so we can just sell a million souvenirs to the zillions of people who will be there?
I'm glad you raised that question. The board of directors of the museum at Portland Headlight is meeting tomorrow evening, and that would be an excellent question to address to the museum director at that time when that entity is meeting.
I happen to know people on that board, so perhaps I'll ask them.
Yeah, just for, it is at the Snow Squall at 6 p.m. The council will be there in their capacity as directors of the Museum of Portland Headlight and directors of the Thomas Jordan Trust. After dinner, there will be a meeting. Even though it is at the Snow Squall, it is a public meeting. Folks are invited. The council will also be having a workshop to discuss Ralph Gould Award, possible recipients, and potential council goals. It has been the leading story on our webpage for 3 or 4 days. We also have gone out of our way to make sure all of the media knows that this meeting is occurring, so that it is unusual for the Cape Town Council to even have a workshop meeting in another community, but we have really tried to get the word out. Councillor Swift-Kiata, you can ask that question to Cheryl. I haven't specifically asked the question. I know there are some issues with trying to get our volunteers in and out. And
get there at 7 in the morning.
I haven't spoken to Cheryl in about a week and a half, so Mike? I need to talk to her again.
I either read or she told me that she had actually ordered additional merchandise.
Did I hear that? She
yeah.
did.
So I assume
that's good.
She's prepared.
We expect to do a lot more business over the course of the whole weekend of itself. There's going to be that many people around. And, you know, also if the Board of Trustees of the Museum of Portland Headlight wish to make a donation, that would be a decision of the Board of Trustees whether or not they want to contribute to the town of Cape Elizabeth in order to help pay for some of this
Because proceeds from the museum shop go where? Now, just as a point of information.
It goes to the separate trust fund or fund
Headlight.
For the museum at Portland Headlight, which just as you have a financial report that the trustees have received,
right.
Which had a good year.
Yes, right. An excellent year.
Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I mean, it's hard to let a money opportunity slide by. It really is. Is there any way, and I'm sure you've thought of it, but to do like a VIP area and charge money like we do for Beach to Beacon and have like the bleachers out at Fort Williams for OpSale?
We can't see the OpSale from the bleachers just a little bit down through the tunnel. I think everybody wants to be on the edge, don't you think?
Well, I don't know if you set them back high enough on the
You mean portable? You're talking about portable.
Portable bleachers and not use the bleachers that are there.
No, portable. No. Portable bleachers like Beach to Beacon, sell them. I mean, that's the Scottish in me coming out. I apologize, but.
My hope is that the trustees of the museum at Portland Headlight may be very generous to defer the cost.
That's not such a bad idea. It's too bad we didn't think about these things, you know, prior to. You know, a couple of weeks away from the event.
That's actually an issue. But I have to say that this is not an issue. This has been talked about among the department chairs related to this for quite some time, because I know I mentioned it when we had wherever that lunch we were at, we talked about it. Where were we? That one, yeah. And this is not something new. It has been discussed. It's a lot of issues concerned. You can't collect at the gate. Traffic will be backed up to Southport. I mean, there was a whole lot of issues. So, and I think they really did talk about them. So.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I move that we remove this item that was tabled in June.
Second.
Moved and seconded. This item removed from the table. All those in favor? Opposed? The motion carries. Now, where's that motion?
Remove, Madam Chair?
So, Madam Chair, am I clear that if we vote tonight to take $10,000 from undesignated funds, which comes from taxpayers, we could tomorrow night vote to donate from...
Not we, the council. We, the board.
Well, but we, the trustees...
Trustees.
Yeah. Could vote to donate $10,000 to the town to make up for that.
Sounds like collusion, doesn't it?
Well, but I think that's an appropriate... I think that's an appropriate place for the cost of this to come from.
From the gift shop?
I think we expect more money to come in to the gift shop, and otherwise, I would be in favor of charging parking.
I think, you know, the only amount that would need be needed is $9,000 because of the donation from Off Sale itself, but, you know, that's a decision that that other body will have to make.
Mm-hmm. Well, we could say up to $9,000 or $10,000, mm-hmm. whatever, to be determined sort of at the end when we see what's owed, you know what I mean? And if we had by chance gotten mm-hmm. some donation from somebody else, then we wouldn't need to use it all.
Yeah, but the town still needs to appropriate the full amount, and then any revenues, you know, just as you do in the budget,
right.
any revenues are an offset, but you need to authorize the full amount of spending.
Okay, you're going to continue now, right?
Yes, Madam Chair, I move that we authorize the town manager to appropriate $10,000 from the undesignated fund balance to pay for town expenses related to the Off Sale 2000 event being held in the Greater Portland from July 28th to the 31st.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any more discussion?
How much is the police overtime estimated?
You remember?
$1,500.
Straight time, on the overtime.
Just on the overtime.
And the fire department call?
Including, that is about 2,000 total.
Thank you.
How many porta potties are we ordering?
30. And what the chief said didn't include the related cost of insurances.
Right.
Workers' comp.
Right, correct. The only thing is that that's just on the 28th. We're not really planning anything for any of the other days. However, you never know with the vessels leaving whether we're going to have to call in added people at that particular time.
When are they sailing out?
Maybe they're not.
Pardon me?
They're not sailing out as a group. They're sailing out at different times. We also have another ship that's coming in like 3 days earlier. That may cause some impacts. It's particularly going to be a burden on public works. We're also, for instance, we usually have one ranger on duty. We're going to have two rangers on duty most of the weekend. So, you know, we're gearing up in general.
There are.
And, you know, that is, there's some expenses. And public works, we're having come in. Do they know this yet? The time they're coming in that morning at 5 a.m. So we're incurring overtime costs because the Fort Williams is going to be open at 6 a.m. Usually it opens at sunrise. But that was so nebulous with telling people 6 a.m. But we need to have Public Works does all of our parking, and we need to make sure that they're in there ready to set up and ready to go when we begin to let the cars in, because if the cars start parking wrong, then we get a couple hundred fewer cars.
How will Cape residents know about the shuttle?
It's going to be in the courier. Chief Williams has been coordinating that with Debbie Butterworth of the courier. The one that's coming out this Friday or Saturday.
Councilor McGinty.
Yeah. I don't know if depressed is the right word. I'm
discouraged.
Unhappy that we, you know, we're at this point anyway. You know, we have this Off Sale 2000, this huge event, and you know, it's been in the newspaper that they're not covering the cost of all the cities. And Portland, I think, is up to like $200,000 they're going to have to spend on this. And South Portland, I don't know, I'm sure it's
nearly
a heftier. Yeah, and, you know, they claim that because the event doesn't, none of their events occur in Cape Elizabeth, yet they advertise the city, you know, the parade starts at Portland Headlight. You know, what do they think is going to happen? And I'm just disappointed we got this far. I guess I'm disappointed more in Off Sale 2000. I don't want to lay the blame on Mike or anybody else, but it's too bad that we, you know, the situation, an outside situation that really is not occurring in our town has such a financial impact, you know, on us. So.
Because we live in the most glorious place in the area.
You know, the price you pay, is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, I guess so.
Like
all right.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to make one more comment because it has to do with Rick Barker, and we've talked about volunteers all night, and this is another example of someone stepping forward in another way, helping out the citizens and Cape Elizabeth by donating radios that we need. If he were not doing that, and there weren't willingness of people like him to do similar things, I mean, we'd incur all kinds of different costs. So I just want to again thank Rick Barker and everybody like him that makes a contribution in any way that they do to help other people.
His wife volunteers on the rescue, by the way.
I know it's getting very late, but similarly, I didn't mention the fire police unit is going to be down there directing traffic with no compensation, those volunteers. The wet team is going to be offshore in case there's any issues right there by the rocks during that entire morning. And the rescue prepay is going to be there as well.
See, you saved yourself another $1,000.
Yeah, really?
Helping out.
I'd like to move the question here. Then we have a motion on the table. Any more discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? None. Carries. I'm on a roll now. Let's move to item number 21, consideration of a report from the town engineer regarding the proposed project to place dugouts at Holman Field and Capano Fields. You've seen the report. Well, you want to make do you want to summarize this?
Yes. Earlier, the council had authorized design for dugouts at Holman Field and Capano Field, which are the softball and baseball field over between the middle school and the high school. We discovered subsequent to that that ADA requirements are that the dugouts be ADA accessible. So therefore, we're not only looking at the dugout expense, we're also looking at the expense of pathways and design. We're looking at a planning board permit, which we didn't need before, which really drives up the cost because of the additional layout that you need for the, you know, the site plan, the attendance at meetings, and the rest of it. Anyway, so it's $6,610 for all of the design services, and then we also have the expense thereafter of all of the ADA pathwork. We'll remind you that the dugouts have been are being donated, the dugouts themselves, by interested parties. There's someone who's already agreed to donate the brick for it, and the groups. They're going to be beautiful dugouts if and when they're built. And I also mentioned that, you know, if you're really hesitant about the $6,610, just in the last year we received $11,000 in pledge donations from the Fields for Cape Kids, and those monies we don't budget as income, nor do we include them as accounts receivable. So it's not as if we don't have money coming in for Fields. We'll also get over $5,000 this year as pledges are continued, although I think we're just about at the final end of that. But so you have two choices. You can defer this issue to the annual budget review, or you could fund the design cost of $6,610.
Wait a minute. What happened to the, why can't we fund the whole cost if we wanted to?
Oh, you could do that, too. But we don't.
Because the money's already there.
But it hasn't been designed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. I see the design.
I think I indicated,
$15,000.
Council Watson.
Madam Chair, I have a question for Manager McGovern. The $15,000 that you estimated, somewhere in here it mentioned that, I think it OSS report, that Public Works maybe could do some of the work. Does $15,000, is it your estimate or proposal that Public Works would do the work but it still costs $15,000, or is $15,000 and that's budgeting even if Public Works didn't do it and we put it out to another firm?
Public Works would do some of it, but part of this is, in addition to ramping, we're probably looking at a stairway, and concrete stairs are very expensive. And the stairways themselves would contract out, you know, the purchase of railings if those were necessary. But again, that hasn't been designed. But that does imply, you know, Public Works would go in and do most of the rough grading and bringing in the, you know, the rough gravel, but then would bring in another company to do the paving. And but they would do the site prep work. Except for the stairways, the railings, and the actual paving.
And that $15,000 would have to come out of the town's budget to do that, or is there some other pot of money somewhere that we have, like the $11,000, that would fund that?
Well, the $11,000 is there, it's a fact, but it would, you know, we have revenues coming in, but they haven't been specifically allocated for this project, so you'd really need to appropriate the money with the understanding that between last year and this year, we're getting $16,000. But it's 15 plus 6610. It's 21,000. That's 6610's not included in the 15,000.
So the likelihood is the town would have to come up with 5,000 approximately.
Yeah. And I don't know, do we have an estimate, John, for the how much the dugouts themselves, the cost, including the value of the donated materials? This is John Chapman.
I don't have a firm estimate, no. We're guessing somewhere around 10,000 for the brick. We're thinking that the cement blocks and poured cement will be donated, and of course all the labor will be donated.
If you add it all together, it's probably a little bit over 20. There's four dugouts all together. There's two at each field.
Councilor Fritz.
Just to clarify, that money from Fields for Kids, isn't that coming in still as pledges for the field at Fort Williams and Lions Field? So that it's not applicable to this, is that right?
It's not directly applicable. We don't budget that as income, nor do we have an accounts receivable listed. So that is, in fact, added income at this time, even though they were pledges, but we...
But they were pledges toward those fields, weren't they?
They were, but the town went ahead and spent the money to get those done, and we did not book this income, so this is technically new income at this time.
But it was expected that money would come in, because that's how it was decided
right.
That they would be billed, was based on the pledges coming in.
Based on 150,000 total in
right.
Gifts and pledges.
So I don't think that's new money. That's...
So are we saying, am I hearing you correctly that Fields for Kids probably owes us money?
Right.
It's
coming
in some pledges. But we haven't booked it. So that, you know, we're not listing it as receivable. For accounting purposes, it's new money. For, you know, pledge purposes, it's old money. Sometimes we book revenue, like taxes.
Yeah.
The taxes that we're collecting now from prior years, we had already booked as revenue. So that doesn't count as new revenue.
No.
We never booked these receivables. So that is included as new revenue during our current financial reporting period.
But that's pretty creative, I mean.
That it is.
Can I ask one question? That begs the question. I mean, is there money that we can go back to Field for Kids and say, to do this, we need to get
5,000 more?
5,000 or how much more from you?
They are providing the 5,000 more through Little League this year. It's a part of their pledge. Plus, they're providing the 25,000 odd dollars in for the dugouts themselves. In terms of the labor and the materials.
Councilor McGinty.
This would be a wash, though. I mean, this $11,000 came in to pay off the $150,000 we paid out.
Yeah.
Now, all we're doing, rather than, quote, unquote, paying down the $150,000, we're going to take this money and use it for a different purpose. I mean, but...
Related purpose.
But it's still money that's owed... I don't know if owed's the right word.
Owed.
Owed to us, yeah.
Owed.
So, can I ask another question? So, are we now saying that we are owed $150,000?
No. Most of the money came in as cash. There were a couple of pledges. There was a pledge from Hannaford Brothers. There was a pledge from the youth soccer program. And there was a pledge from Little League. And those have been coming in each and every year.
Okay.
Without any prompting.
They were pledges over time.
Over time.
Okay. All right.
And the deal was, when we did Fields for Cape Kids, was that we would not recognize any revenue. And the auditors won't let us recognize any revenue unless it's expected within the first 12 months. Because under generally accepted accounting principles, you can't recognize revenue unless it's expected within the next accounting period, which for us is the fiscal year is 12 months.
Councilor Roberts.
What is the manager recommending, that we fund the design cost and move to the budget?
The 6610, right. Yes.
Can I make that motion?
Go for it.
I would move that we provide the funding for $6,610, provide for the design review of the dugouts at Holman and Capano Fields.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you very much. Item number 22, consideration of request from the residents of the proposed Sparrow Lane to change the name of their road to Harriman Farm Road.
Madam Chairman, it was nice to have a neighborhood that was unanimous.
Yeah.
This is off Mitchell Road, and Harriman used to live in the house up at the corner. And there is one of the residents, Christine Newell, here. I don't know if she's here on this, but I presume she might have come tonight because of this. But our understanding from the Salikases and from the Drynans and from the Newells is that they're all in favor.
Wow, this is good. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
The minutes will reflect that the motion was...
Yeah, and concurrent with that...
Oh, yes, do have an additional change, right?
Yeah, where
came
is it?
In. This isn't the right piece of paper.
Here. It's underneath here somewhere.
Here.
Yeah. Is Berry Lane, something we were going to call Berry Lane, is over across from the Inn by the Sea. Some of you may be familiar with that little road there. We had gone to them. We were going to call it Berry Lane. And again, everyone on the street has lined up against Berry Lane. And they want, after given several options and going back and forth with Chief Williams, they want Beach Rose Lane. And this has gone through the 911 committee. They don't have any objection. And I really want you to note the other point I made in the email is that we don't want, sorry, Henry, we don't want... It was another Berry. We don't want for these to keep coming back. And up to this point, we've said it has to be unanimous, or we won't even think of bringing it to the council, and that because we're now beginning to incur costs, it needs to be cut off date. As I mentioned, there's some issues in People's Cove that should have been reviewed with them earlier to a larger extent than it was, and we're trying to review that. And that's really the only one I can see bringing back to the council based on what's been in the 911. We don't want to keep revisiting this, but again, under the Constitution, folks do have the right to petition the council, but we're letting them know that if it's not unanimous, they're not likely to have the council be accommodated. So I'd like to have both of those.
Can we amend the motion?
Yes, absolutely.
Councillor Watson has amended the motion to include both these changes. Road recommendations changes, and who was the seconder?
I was.
Oh.
And although their first choice was C. Rose Lane, we
knocked that out because of too many C's already.
Geez, I like that one, though. But anyway.
I think it's a terrible substitution in either case.
Yeah. All right. All those in favor?
Opposed?
None. Thank you. It carries. We're getting into the bewitching hour here. I'm moving along. Item number 23. Consideration of a request to issue a quitclaim deed to Patricia LaChance as personal representative of the estate of Mary P. Haskell to clear a title of a property that did not have a properly discharged lien back in the late 1950s.
I'd like this to be approved with the change to have it go to Michael A. Butler Sr. and Christine M. Butler, who as of last Friday would be the new owners.
Madam Chairman, I would like to move that the manager be authorized to execute a quitclaim deed on behalf of the town to accomplish this transfer of the interest.
Second.
Of the town.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you very much. Is there any items of discussion not on the agenda that would like to be brought forward by the citizens? Hearing none, we'll go to item number 24, consideration of a request from the town manager to enter into executive session to review proposed collective bargaining agreements with the Cape Elizabeth Benevolent Association, representing police officers, sergeants, the head dispatcher and dispatchers, and with Local 340 of the Teamsters, representing certain public works employees. I'm going to read these other two so that they know what goes on. Because we have to have a recommendation. No? So we just do item number 24?
Yeah. Just, you want me to briefly?
Yes.
There's two items that follow this. One is to, that suggests that there may be a public meeting afterward to approve a proposed police contract, provided all goes well in executive session. The council may be asked to do that and vote on that this evening. The second item is a proposed collective bargaining agreement, Local 340 of the Teamsters, representing certain public works employees. It'll be the staff's recommendation that this be tabled at the appropriate time. We expected the Teamsters local to have voted on it prior to now, and they have in fact not. So we're going to ask that to be tabled.
Okay, we have a motion to go to executive session.
So moved. Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we go to executive session to take up the two items as read, item number 24 and item number 25. Is there any more discussion? There will be no action taken on these. This is an information for the council. There will be no voting during executive session. All those in favor? Opposed? I would recommend adjournment.
So moved?
No.
No, we can't do it?
No, we can't. That's what we get
out. Oh, okay, great. Okay. Yep, okay.
If you don't want to get the sound back in, that's what you...